Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Good evening. This is a very prestigious collection figures and elegance of nephrology in Egypt and Arab world. So thank you very much for attending this special, very special webinar. First of all, let me to start with in Arabic to introduce Professor Hany Hafez. I know that he is well-known figure in Egypt and Arab world and Africa. It is a good opportunity for me to introduce him. طبعا أستاذ الدكتور هاني حافظ ورئيس الجمعية المصرية الحالي طبعا لأمراض وزراعة الكلى وإن أنا شخصيا بعتز بمعرفته منذ الواحد كان يعني مدرس مساعد ومدرس طول عمره الدكتور هاني صاحب واجب وفضل ونيفر انفايتد ما كانش بتأخر عني في أي مكان. أنا هعمل جيرني سريعة يعني بحيث ما أخدش أكتر من 3-4 دقايق بعض الصور الهامة جدا يعني أو يعني اللطيفة الـ very recent طبعا ده كان في الإمارات طبعا مع الأعلام مع الدكتور رشاد ومن السودان والدكتور عمر عبود والجروب من السودان ده طبعا كان في مركز الكلى دايما الدكتور هاني عمره ما دعيته أو يعني في أي كورس من اللي احنا بنعمله وتأخر ودايما يعني بيجي بيته يعني الدكتور هاني محبوب من الجميع عندنا يعني ده دكتور هاني لما تسلم رئاسة الجمعية في فبراير 2018 من الدكتور جمال السعدي وطبعا هي الجمعية المصرية جمعية طبعا فعلا جمعية متميزة جدا متميزة لأن فيها روح المد والعطاء من كل واحد بيسلم للتاني ويمكن ده كان أول اجتماع مجلس إدارة أنا بنتهز هذه الفرصة الدكتور كمال عكاشة فين بنتمنى له طبعا الدكتور كمال كل الشفاء وعندي أخبار طيبة أنه الحالة العامة احسن ان شاء الله ويبقى قريبا معانا وان شاء الله اول ما يتعافى ان شاء الله يعمل برزنتيشن تاني ويعود لمحبيه وتلامذته وطبعا دكتور كمال نائب رئيس جامعه طنطا يعني راجل من الاعلام الموجودين ديت الصوره دي انا بعتز بها دكتور هاني لانه انا لمست فيها مدى الحب والتقدير والاحترام المتبادل يعني حضرتك لما نطلع نعمل برزنتيشن دويتو برزنتيشن في حاجه ان حضرتك بتحبها ودايما بتعملها فكنت حضرتك تديني الفرصه ان ابقى معاك في البرزنتيشن فده مش اي يعني اعتقد مش لاي حد حضرتك تدي له كده فانا لمست فعلا معزتي عند حضرتك صور بقى من المتعدده ومن الترانسبلانتيشن شابتر معانا الدكتور غنيمات من الاردن طبعا بنحبه الدكتور طارق الباز ما يعني واحد ما يعرفش يوصف المحبه والدكتور ايمن طبعا الدكتور عمرو حسين وروح الفريق اللي موجوده ديت اللي خلت شعبه الترانسبلانتيشن مؤتمر قوي جدا جدا في حد ذاته. يعني ده السنه دي في 2020 مؤتمر الجمعيه كان يضاهي جميع المؤتمرات الدوليه والامريكيه لانه كان قوي جدا جدا بفضل التعاون والتضافر وطبعا في الصور فيها اساتذه من بره ومن جوه لكن دي جزء من شخصيه الدكتور هاني المحب ده مع احفاده. فهو انا بحس ان هو بيتعامل معايا كانه بيتعامل مع احفاده بس فالواحد دايما بيعتز يعني باللمسه الانسانيه في الدكتور هاني. برحب بنا بالتمريض. الجزء بقى اللي ما يخصني في التعليم الطبي المستمر طبعا الجمعيه السايد ده بدا على ايدين الدكتور طارق الباز لما عمل بوش جامد جدا في السي ام اي وكان بيتعمل فيس تو فيس وبعد كده عملنا الفيرشوال اكاديمي وتطورت يعني الوقت ده عدد المحاضرات يعني اعتقد عدد لا نهائي في النفرولوجي بيصعب على طلب الدكتوراه الكلى انه يلحقوا حتى الجديد من فيديوهات وغيره. لكن الجديد النهارده اللي بنقدمه لحضرتك ان احنا فعلنا الجزء ده بحيث انه على الكلينيكال نفرو في ممكن اي يعني اي حد من الزملاء يخش على كلينيكال نفرولوجي او ترانسبلانت نفرولوجي او الداليسيس ويكتب قصه عيان او سؤال وبدانا النهارده سجلنا الاجابه على الكلوروكين والهيدروكس كلوروكين في الكوفيد 19 في التريتمنت والبروفلاكسس وده كان سؤال موجود وهنعمل القصه دي. جزء برضو مفاجاه ان مع الدكتور هاني بنطور التعليم عن بعد طبعا الاطباء الشغل مشغل النهار وكل يوم لكن الجديد ان الاربع القادم ان شاء الله اول ويبينار في بدايه سلسله الكونتينوس نيرس ايدوكيشن عن بعد وهيبقى في دالاس كلاب وكلينيكال نيفرولوجي وترانسبلانت كلاب فور نيرسز يبقى بحيث التمريض مع الاطباء هاند ان هاند في التعليم. الدكتور هاني يعني انسان في السفر، يعني صاحب في السفر ده حاجه كبيره جدا. فانا دي كانت في الامارات، كان واحد فعلا لمس مدى الطيبه والبساطه والانسانيه الراقيه جدا من الدكتور هاني، والتواضع يعني ما فيش احسن من كده. اللمسه اللي قالها الدكتور فيصل وحرقها لي برضو، الكتاب طبعا هو عده كتب الدكتور هاني، عنده الناحيه الادبيه جميله جدا، وده بتوري ان الانسان فعلا انسان موسوعه في كل شيء. ده كتاب السنه دي 2020 فريش خالص اهوت، يعني ابديتد 212 صفحه، فيه قصص العمر وحاجات مفيده جدا لاي حد ممكن يستمتع بهذا الكتاب. وده اخر سلايد، يمكن استخدمتها في احد البرزنتيشن في الاسمبلي بتاع الجامعه المصريه، واحب اقولها لانه الجامعه المصريه منذ الواحد اتعامل مع رؤسائها بجميع الاجيال، من اول الدكتور صبري جوهر اللي انا مدين له بالفضل في المنصوره نيفروجي كلاب لما دخله تبع الجمعيه، وده كان اول ارهاصات الديستنس ليرنينج في مصر في النيفرولوجي. مرورا بقى بجميع الاساتذه ورؤساء الجمعيه، احب اقول انه فعلا الجمعيه تيم وورك، روح الفريق ده فعلا بالمحبه، والبورد الجمعيه طبعا معانا الدكتور مجدي الشرقاوي ومعانا كل الناس، والدكتور طارق الباز طبعا الجمعيه العربيه والمصريه وكل حاجه. فانا بستعير بس الابيات ديت برضه عشان اغازل الدكتور هاني، ولانها حاجه مهمه جدا. ده في ابيات في فصل سنه رابعه ابتدائي، بتحكي ازاي ان التعاون ممكن يعمل المعجزات. فالشعر: اني رايت نمله في حيره بين الجبال، لم تستطع حمل الطعام وحدها فوق الرمال، ناغت على اخت لها تعينها فالحمل مال، لم تستطيع حمله تذكر قولا يقال، تعاونوا جميعكم فالخير يأتي بالوصال، نالت على إخوانها جاءوا جميعا بالحبال، جروا معا طعامهم لم يعرفوا شيئا محال. واحد زائد واحد الدكتور هاني ما بيسويش اثنين، ده بيسوي 20. وإحنا النهاردة الجمعية المصرية زي ما قال الدكتور فيصل شاهين في محاضرته، إنه سمت كويس للجمعية المصرية إنه حتى الجمعية العربية أو الأساتذة العرب والفيجرز الموجودين في الدول العربيه كلهم بيشاركونا بخبراتهم العميقه. ويمكن بدا الدكتور فيصل، والاسبوع ده في الدكتور ابراهيم سعيد من جامعه الامام عبد الرحمن بن فيصل، وفي اخر شهر يونيو يوم 26 الدكتور سعيد الغامدي، وهكذا. وكان امبارح معانا الدكتور احمد عقل. فكله ان شاء الله ما نتعاون هنعمل بلاتفورم لمصر والدول العربيه يستحق كل الاحترام والتقدير، وده بفضل طبعا الروح اللي حضرتك بتتميز بها الدكتور هاني. انا متاكد النهارده لان حضرتك من يعني متميز للغايه في الاطلاع على الجديد والمفيد، ودايما بتصبر يعني الصبر على التعلم وتتابع البرزنتيشن، ودي حاجه الواحد بيتعلمها من حضرتك. النهارده انا متاكد انها هتخلي الامريكان ترانسبلانت كونجرس اللي انعقد من 30 مايو ل 3 يونيو على الفيرتشوال ميتينجز، يعني هتخلينا كأن احنا حضرناه. فمنتظرين من حضرتك واتس هوت اند واتس نيو، وانا متاكد ان شاء الله ان تبقى حلقه متميزه جدا جدا من حلقات الويبينار. اتفضل يا دكتور هاني.
الف شكر يا دكتور حسين على الكلام الجميل. الحقيقه انت عملت برزنتيشن اكثر مما استحق
يا باشا،
اشكرك جدا جدا. والحقيقه يعني الكلام اللي حضرتك قلته يعني احلى حاجه فيه انه طالع من القلب، لان انا بحبك زي ما انت بتحبني يا حسين.
ده طبعا اهم حاجه. طبعا احنا معانا الدكتوره مي برضه، احنا بنعز الدكتوره مي كمان، فعلى ما حضرتك تعمل
شير. طبعا الدكتوره مي. قول لي بقى دلوقتي انا ادوس على البرزنتيشن وابتدي
احسن. اعمل شير كده، اعمل شير كده،
اعمل شير تاني ولا كده ظهرت؟
لا لا لا، اعمل اضغط على شير سكرين وافتحها، بس لازم تبقى مينمايزد برضه.
شير سكرين وبعدين كده افتحها.
تمام
كده ظهرت.
تظهر، بتظهر، بتحمل خلاص كده. تمام حضرتك اعملها بس شو سلايد شو.
انا بدوس على سلايد شو.
تمام
ممكن. ايوه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طبعا شرف لي ان انا ابقى مع حضراتكم، واشكركم جميعا على التواصل في هذه الويبينار، امل ان هو يكون ذو فائده لينا جميعا. بدايه طبعا انا باقدم التعازي في وفاه الاستاذ الدكتور هاني رفعت اخونا الحبيب، وقبلها الدكتور عمرو عبيد، وطبعا الحمد لله ان اساتذتنا اللي اصيبوا عرفت النهارده ان الدكتور هاني ابو زيد احسن وتقريبا عرفت ان هو راح البيت، وسمعت دلوقتي برضو ان الدكتور كمال عكاشة بيتحسن، فأأمل اننا نعدي كلنا من الايرا بتاعه الكوفيد
ان شاء الله
بدون خسائر ونكون كلنا اصحاء سليمين. الامريكان ترانسبلانت كونجرس this is the first virtual meeting for it ever، لان هو دايما الحقيقه هو من اهم الكونجرسز في ترانسبلانتيشن، واول مره يتعمل فيرتشوال لظروف الكورونا. والحقيقه كان في الايام اللي فاتت من 30 مايو وانتهت في 1 يونيو كان عندي البريفيليج ان انا ادخل على كل السلايدز وكل السيشنز بتاعته، وبالتالي انا هقسم الاجنده بتاعتي انتو 6 بارتس، وعايزكم ما تزهقوش معايا ان شاء الله عندنا يعني بعض الوقت، يعني فرصه ان انا المتحدث الوحيد النهارده. ففي البارت الاول هيبقى انترودكشن، هنتكلم فيه على البريزيدنشال ادرس اللي اتقالت في هذا المؤتمر واهم التوكس اللي اتقالت كده اوفر فيو. بارت 2 هاو تو اوفركم اورجان شورتج، از يو نو ان اور ذات اورجان شورتج از ا بيج بروبلم in the world, not only in the United States, it's everywhere. And what are the solutions for this organ shortage? Part three is the tolerance. Are there any advances in the direction of tolerance in the world, or it's still elusive? Part four, how to diagnose rejection? What are the up-to-date investigations or possible ways to diagnose rejection? Part five, immunosuppressives and desensitization, what's new and hot in this field, and what are the presentations? And lastly, the basic advances, because I know that many of you don't like very much the basic advances, but we will run through them, because without these basic advances, usually we don't reach clinical advances. So let's embark, ربطوا الأحزمة وهنبتدي بالintroduction. الحقيقة in this presentation I tried to review more than 300 oral and poster presentations, but because I have a taste for the kidney I tried to select the kidney transplant, because as you know the American Transplant Congress is dealing with all organs, not only kidney. And also I tried to summarize the session of Hot and New, which was presented by Dori Sigi from Johns Hopkins giving what's new in the clinical, and Andrew Adams from MROI giving what's new in the basic sciences. I went to revise all the plenaries, and I tried to include them, all of them, and you see a list of the most important plenaries here. By the way, number two has been ranked as the best plenary abstract presentation about older organ transfer senescence to transplant recipients, and we will go for it with details after some time. And you will find all these plenary lectures distributed in my talk. The presidential address, this is the president of the American Transplant Congress. In his address, actually, he was addressing the duality of the problem now and what he needs in the future. He needs a better access, better availability, and a better outcome for the transplantation. Because in spite of the advances of the United States in the field of transplantation, they are not able to cover all those people who need transplantation. And there is always a sort of duality between the supply and the demand, the access and the outcome, the equity and the utility, the local and the sharing, the living donors and the deceased donors. After a big area of going to deceased donors, they are coming back again to living donors. Innovation versus what is present in the states now, biological obstacles and man-made obstacles. And he concentrated on the political impact. As you know, the president of the United States has got a plan to have 80% of the new end-stage renal disease either start on home dialysis or preemptive transplantation within a short period. And he got another plan to compensate those who will refer patients for transplantation. And also, he spoke about this, and he spoke also about a need for change of the logistics or the metrics revision in the United States. Because the waiting list, the organ selection, and the organ function, and the quality of life, and all this needs to be readdressed. And I will go in my presentation to show you what are the defects present and how they want it to be in the future. So creating the future in his context, move from a punitive system to one with both carrots and sticks. You should not punish the doctors and the health professionals for bad outcome. You have to have more efficient organ allocation and distribution and increase funding for transplant research. You have to have new tool for better communication and collaboration, and maybe the webinars now is a tool that is coming in the COVID area. You have to diversify the workforce, system engineers, policy workers, organizational psychologists, and mediators. All of them should be integrated together to have great progress. And we need to be more collaborative, compromising, and rapid. We must never forget the importance of offering hope, because he was speaking in the time of COVID with no hope. By this introduction, I will start directly to move to part two, how to overcome organ shortage. As you know, all over the world, we transplant much less than the needs of end organ failures. And we have actually, in this Congress, they have spoken about four big items to overcome this organ shortage. I will start by the xenotransplantation, in spite that now in the COVID area, we don't like the animals and the disease transmission transmitted by them like the bats, but this will be discussed. We will speak again about motivation, because motivation has got two aspects. One of it will be very ethical questions about it, which is the medical assistance in dying, donation, and other modification, whether financial or other. Number three, old grafts modified, because we know that the old grafts carry poor prognosis. So how to make old grafts rejuvenated or ready to be of long prognosis, not of short prognosis. And last point is going to transplant the high risk patients, and don't be afraid from the punishment by the UNOS system or the USRDS database when they see that your results are not good. And also to go for paired donation, which is increasing in the United States and elsewhere, including Saudi Arabia. Let's start by the first aspect, which is the xenotransplantation. And as you know, in this middle, you see a pig with CRISPR-Cas. This CRISPR-Cas is a sort of changing the genetics of this pig to be similar to the baboons or to other animals. In this way, this genetic modification of the pig to baboon allow transplantation of the pig to these baboons weighing 6 to 9 kilograms, and selection of the baboon was based on low anti-pig antibody levels. And in this study from Alabama, they transplanted 14. Here you see 14 baboons, and they got different survivals from as short as 1 day to up to 260 days. So very, you have here 255, 237. So you succeeded to overcome the very short period of the early days of xenotransplantation. How they did this? They did this by giving an anti-CD40 monoclonal antibody-based immunosuppression. And this was the induction ATG and rituximab, anti-CD20. And the maintenance was this anti-CD40 monoclonal antibody with rapamycin and steroids. And they got a reasonably long-term xenograft survival, and which gives hope in the future. This is the first presentation about xenotransplant. The second xenotransplant paper was dealing with a good idea that if you are afraid from this highly hypersensitive antibodies, why not to get the idea of IDIS? Remember the IDIS? I will go through it rapidly. This is a sort of destruction of the antibody by this for a short period. And this will give us a sort of depletion, allowing us to go for transplantation. So they give the animals, each received a single dose of IDIS, 10 milligram per kilogram intravenous, followed by serial serum sample, which was analyzed by a flow cytometry-based xenoreactive cross-match assay. And as soon as they got a low level, they went, because this IDIS is the degrading enzyme of the strept pyogenes, the effect appears within 1 hour, and the IgG was low up to 10 to 14 days. So during this window period, they went and transplanted the animals. So this is a very good idea. And you see here what they did exactly. This is the baboon and the xenograft IgG to reduce the donor-specific antibody. And this is the IDIS here is given. And when the IDIS is given, you find that the graft is not destructed, as you see here. While if the IDIS is not given, the complement will destruct the graft, as you see in the upper label. And therefore, there was significant reduction in the level of xenoreactive IgG antibody after treatment with IDIS. Very bright idea. And they actually did this in three baboons. And the result was good. And the application for this in the future will be to permit a therapeutic window for transplantation of moderately high xenoreactive IgG recipient, and also to deal for the treatment for the ABMR in xenotransplant. The third paper dealing with this xenotransplantation, successful control and getting free survival of kidney xenograft with triple xenoantigen knockout plus insertion of multiple human transgenes, more than 200 day survival of pig kidney. Here I mentioned in the previous slide, again, other trial of more than 200 disease survival by a triple hit using different immunosuppressants. This is about the xenotransplantation. What about the second option? I know the second option will be very, very debated, especially in Islamic countries, because it was about the fourth type of donation, which is imminent death donation or medical assistance in dying. So what are they doing? You can understand what they are doing when you know that the types of organ donation that we know are three: living donors, donors after brain death, donors after cardiac death, and imminent death donation is the fourth one. What is meant by imminent death donation? It means simply that you try to give an injection for those very advanced cases near dying because of any medical disease, suffering from a medically futile condition, with foreseeable deaths. The patient initiated request to become assessed as potential deceased organ donor in advance of dying, and they will give him what we call euthanasia, or a sort of injection that will promote or fasten his death, and they will get the organ. And actually, this paper was presented by the Canadian in this Congress, because there was a law started in 2016, began accepting this offer in 2018, and these are the results of the first patients, first grafts taken by this. So our institution early experience is encouraging, with low warm ischemia time, favorable early graft function result, because of course very short ischemia time, and they call it medical assistance in dying. And this has been presented in the Congress by from London, Canada. In the United States, there is still a debate about that. The pros for this, as you see, reduced ischemic damage to the organ, more compassionate end-of-life care, because maybe the dead person feels that he gave a gift for those people after him who will get benefit from his organs, may increase the number of organs, of course, and reliable organ recovery as opposed to failure to progress to asystole, because the poor results when you get organs donation after cardiac death. But the barrier for this, or the cons, are the lack of definition and boundaries, because actually you are doing a sort of homicide, and lack of stakeholder buy-in or assignment of roles and responsibility. And what is more important, actually, potential to compromise the public trust and the opinion about organ donation, while increasing confusion on appropriate end-of-life care. And imagine this questionnaire that they did in the United States and published. If we do it in our countries, what will be the result? This is top concern regarding this method of donation. It may be possible for patient to have some recovery after a devastating brain injury. 34% said this. Maybe he will be living. I'm concerned that doctors would not try as hard to save the patient's life. This process could take advantage of vulnerable population. It may be difficult to obtain consent for imminent death donation. Many concern. And in addition, I support the option of imminent death donation here, but not necessary for life before the withdrawal of life support. Of course, I am not sure if this will be equally distributed, these organs will be equally distributed. Many concerns. But Canada went and did 9 cases. Another way for getting more organs is motivation. And motivation has got 2 aspects from the United States perspective. The first aspect is financial, and the second aspect is care for the donors. Let's start by care for the donors. And this publication about the M-Kidney system, which is a mobile health tool to improve living donor follow-up. In this way, you can follow up the donor and send messages, email, reminders, text message reminders, and check his clinical questions and laboratory test results. And in this way, the donors are better followed after donation. And this was presented by Caroline from John Hopkins as an abstract. But what about the financial? The financial here is lost wages, travel and lodging reimbursement by the National Kidney Registry, and the total reimbursement processed over the 14 months when they started this in 2019 up to 29 February 2020, 326 donors at 46 transplant program were reimbursed. And the average reimbursement per donor was between $213 up to $6,000. The third aspect to increase the organs is to try to modify the metrics or the rules of the United States. And you see here, the main discussing was Professor Anil Chandrakar here. He is the co-chair of the AST committee for this metric modification. They call it the Joint Transplant Metric Task Force. He came to Egypt during the last ESNT, and you saw with Dr. Hussein his picture. And they discussed that actually they need to do much to change the what is present now, starting from the pre-listing up to the criteria for 1 year survival, up to the a sort of punishment of the places who don't get very good outcome. And all these needs, the principle of the metric system are now in big debate in the United States to encourage people to transplant more cases. So also there is an evidence suggesting that patients prioritize the waitlist access over the post-transplant outcome. This means that if you tell the patient, when you get an old organ, your prognosis will be bad. The patient doesn't care too much because he doesn't care of the post-transplant outcome. You want to go as a priority on the waitlist. So when the patient will go a little bit faster, even if the condition is not very good. When you look to this picture about the list of discarded donors in the United States, you will be astonished that one third of all discarded donors are because of old age of the donors. And you see here the very big gap between the waiting list in pink and the actual transplant in blue. And you will see that in 2019, these are the transplants that has been performed, and every 20 people die each day waiting for a transplant. So therefore, they are in a bad condition, needing to change this metric and going to get these older organs for supply. But because they will think that old graft to be accepted is better than nothing, better than no transplantation. And there have been two presentations coming from John Hopkins. The first one comparing those who accepted the old graft, donor age more than 50, versus those declined who did not accept. And they found that 34.6 of recovered kidneys from donor age were discarded between 2010 and 2018. However, candidates who accepted these diseased kidney donor 50 had 50% decreased mortality risk compared with those who declined the same offer. This means that if you don't take the organ, you have a 50% chance of dying. So taking a poor organ better than getting nothing. In another study, also coming from John Hopkins, adjusted cumulative mortality for high KDPI kidney offer acceptance. As you know, the KDPI, if you have a high KDPI, 80 to 95, here is the difference between the accepted and the declined. And if the KDPI is worse, which is the KDPI means kidney donor profile index, the higher means a worse kidney. So if you have it 96 to 100, of course, this is a very bad kidney. So the difference will be less between those who accepted the offer and those who declined the offer. In conclusion, better to take an old graft. But if you take an old graft, could we do an intelligent way to make this old graft become young? This is the idea of this Stefan Tullius, who came also to Egypt as he was the Secretary General of the TTS, and he came last year in our Congress. He's a genius from working in Boston. And he thought about the threat of transferring aging. Transferring aging means what? That you get the cells of the old, which are actually senescent cells, as you see here, this is the broad consequence of organ aging. You get these senescent cells with extracellular vesicles containing nucleic acids, proteins, and lipids. And when you transfer them to a young donor, you may transfer the bad components, and these organs will not live long. So he had his fellows, or his young fellow, Jasper Eski, the one who presented this, and it got the best abstract award, and his group, to try to prove this concept first, that if you get an old organ put in a young, you are transferring the senescent markers. And another concept after that, that if you put some senolytics or some drugs on these cells, you will make them again young cells, and you can revert the poor prognosis. Let's embark and see their experience. The purpose of old organ represent an underutilized potential. So senescent cells accumulate with aging and secrete a myriad of inflammatory cytokines that may promote senescence in neighboring cells. And these are the previous publication in this. This impaired immune surveillance accelerates accumulation of senescent cells and aging, senescence in health and disease, tissue specificity of senescent cells accumulation during physiologic and accelerated aging of mice. These are previous publication in the last years. So their method, they got hearts from either young or old mice, as you see here. This is a 3 months old mouse, and this is an 18 mouse. So this is an old heart, and this is a young heart. And they put the young heart in a young mouse and the old heart in a young mouse. And you see what will be the result. When you put young plus young, you don't see any bad cells here. But when you see the old heart put in the young, you see some markers, some of these violet spots. What are these violet spots? We call them systemic and local senescent associated secretory phenotypes molecules, or SAPs. These SAPs simply are mitochondrial DNA, P16 and P21. These are the markers here. P16, P21, and mitochondrial DNA, or SAPs. So these SAPs will be present, and these SAPs here are proven when you see this biopsy, not only when you transfer or transplant a heart, but also when you transplant a liver, or when you transplant any organ, the same concept applies. So they proved the concept. If you get an old organ to a young, you get bad prognosis. The mechanism will be what? Because a naive cell, when they become senescent cell, there is a role of this mitochondrial DNA in development of ischemia reperfusion injury. And of course, there will be this mitochondrial DNA will lead to increased cytokines circulating interleukin 6, TNF alpha, promote the TH1 and TH17 immune response. This is the mechanism of why they are bad. So a very brilliant idea. Let's try to absorb these cells and remove them. How to remove them? This young fellow in the same group used senolytics to heart transplantation. And he found that when you give these senolytics versus no senolytics, senolytics means agents which make you young. He used Navito, for example, improving the decreased clearance of senescent cell through senolytic treatment with some agents like Navitoclaxin, for example. When he put this senolytic on the graft, he got a better cardiac survival than when he doesn't put. So this is a way of affecting the mitochondrial DNA, repairing the poor organ, and having a a better transplant survival. This is the previous experience. So the idea is that young recipient of all the cardiac allograft demonstrated increased the frequency of senescent cell, and this is post-operative day 30. They are usually localized in the draining lymph nodes and in the liver, more in the liver, 20-fold in the liver and only three-fold in the draining lymph node, with increase of these SAPs, or the senescent-associated secretory phenotypes. Remember three, P16, P21, and mitochondrial DNA. In an additional experiment, when you put senolytics, for example, dasatinib, quercetin, all these are senolytics applied to young and old donor animal and cardiac transplant, were performed, and we got a better prognosis with the young organ, the old organ becoming young again. The last way to increase the longevity of the graft or the access to more graft is to transplant very highly sensitized patients with end-stage renal disease. In the previous days, the old nephrologists like me and my colleagues were quite afraid of approaching this highly sensitized patient with more than 95% PRA. But this, we call them the very highly sensitized individual. But this is a 10-year experience of the University of Minnesota of many, many cases. And as you see, the patient survival in this series actually was marvelous for a follow-up of almost 5 years. So it seems that we shouldn't be so afraid from desensitized patient with the new modern way of desensitization that we'll address later on. Lastly, in this way to get third donation, or this is a paper presented by an Italian group from University of Padua. But here they will start by the chain by a cadaver. This is the diseased donor initiated chain. So they will not start by an altruistic living donor, no, they will start by a cadaveric donor. And then after that, it will be a classic chain as usual, a domino chain with will start here by a diseased donor. So they started 8 kidney from diseased donor utilized 6 blood type O, and 24 transplants were performed, 16 incompatible pair, 8 waitlisted recipient, and the results were presented in this lab. By this, I finished part 2 of my presentation.
Dr. Hany, if you allow us to have just a couple of comments about this very hot part of the presentation, because we have Professor Faisal Shaheen, who is the president of the International Society of Organ Donation, and he is in the task force, the co-chairman of the task force.
Very good. I would like, after each part, to make a stop.
It's very nice to hear from him the new ideas and in the pipeline of organ donation. Dr. Faisal.
Well, as Tony make it very good and clear, probably the things which is missed is to artificial organ transplantation. Maybe he is going to talk a bit later. But regarding the donor exchange, motion of organ donation from living, it should be more attention, because it is one of the most important source of organ donation, especially in the kidney and the liver. And I am sure that by stem cells also will work in the future, because we cannot utilize everything. The things which you said, the patients after this to take, or the patients who inherent donation, it is not, it will not be accepted in Islamic law by any means.
Of course, yes.
But from our side, exchange of organs is good. Bare donation is good. Desensitization of the high BRA patient also is good. and encourage patients from living donor and all utilize all the deceased donor, because we don't utilize all the deceased donor, maybe this will be more ethical than, more than to take someone who is not is dying or someone who is not brain dead. So
we agree totally with this. I agree totally with you, Dr. Faisal. I will speak about the stem cell and the cell in the next part, maybe on the third part of my presentation.
And I think euthanasia is prohibited in many countries, and even it is not agreed upon in the majority of states in the United States. What is this? Is it growing nowadays, Dr. Faisal, euthanasia and the merciful killing?
No, I think it is not accepted even from our society, ISODB, that this is not accepted practice. Probably it can happen in some small community, which is not accepted from our side.
For merciful killing, it is not agreed upon. So if we add to merciful killing, organ donation, it will be totally unethical in the majority of laws all over the world.
You are right, Dr. Hussein. Even we are, it's a question mark for those donors who have been killed due to some other criminal. And then they became a British, and then this is, you can't take from them, you can't. Still, because they are brain dead, but still there is some ethical question: what is the cause of death of those donors? So I think this is a very extreme to go for ethnicity and take someone who is not dying, who is not a brain dead, who doesn't have cardiac arrest, and then you take from him. I think this is maybe it is like a killer, like to kill someone in order to save another one.
Yes,
but there are many ways to be promoted, to get organs. Many ways government can work hardly to announce that all the brain disease and all cardiac disease is permitted, and this is all of them. This is a very big source, but still we have to work on other alternative, as you mentioned, stem cells. We have to work about taking from animal, which started make it long time back, and it was successful for 3 months to have from baboon liver.
It seems more than 200 days now. It's better. It's improving.
Doctor, so we should work in this. We should work more.
Dr. Faisal, yes, do you have? Yes. What about the activity of bird donation in Saudi and the Gulf?
It is working very good, actually. It is working in the start. We're facing a lot of problems in the start, but when we have a good coordinator to speak with the family about bear donation, we start to have few cases. And now we expanded not one in one center only. We expanded from 3 centers now in Saudi Arabia, and it will expand more in the future, because this will help. Will help for sure some patients with different blood group, with highly sensitized patients, so it can help a lot.
So I'll take the opportunity to invite Professor Maya Hasaballah, because she delivered a very smart presentation about bird donation the last conference. And I think the wind transplantation is resumed, I think, to activate this agenda for bird donation in Egypt. Dr. Maya.
I think this is the only thing from all what Professor Hany mentioned that we can adopt, and we really want to adopt so very much, and I think we should push hard in this direction. Of course, the transplanting the very highly sensitized patients is not that appealing, actually. So we're still afraid to do that. And of course, the imminent death is not accepted by all means. So I think
we'll try after the vanish of Corona, inshallah.
Yes. We should all exert effort in this direction.
Thank you very much, Professor May, and I think we are eager to know to hear from you, Professor Hany, about the tolerance. Yes.
Okay, let's now embark in the third and fourth part of my presentation. I will be speaking shortly about the tolerance. You know, it's an elusive goal that we didn't reach, in spite that it is present around us everywhere in all the pregnancy. Pregnancy induces fetus-specific humoral sensitization, and pregnancy induces T-cell tolerance, increased T regulatory cell, intrinsically dysfunctional T-cells, and we find that the baby is not combated or is not affected by the mother antibodies. So they are trying to study this model, and in spite of this model which is living around us, still tolerance is not reached. But I will give you an idea about some studies. One of them is the Mercury study group by using donor-derived hematopoietic stem cells. And actually, this was the one that Professor Faisal was telling about. Medior Therapeutics prepared this preparation, which is called MDR, probably from Medior, MDR-101, which is actually a sort of a CD34 plus hemopoietic stem cells and CD3 plus T cells. They are given as a single intravenous infusion post-transplantation. And they see observe what will be the effect. This is the phase 3 study. It has been done in many multi-center in different places in the United States. And I think you see many places here. Some of them, you know them, University of Wisconsin. You see Professor Gaber here. You see Thomas Jefferson University. You see many, many, Stanford. All these are sharing in this multi-center open label controlled trial of cellular immunotherapy with MDR-101 for induction of immune tolerance in recipients of HLA-matched living donor kidney transplant. What they are doing is the following. They give here a single intravenous infusion just post-transplantation. And then at 6 months, they start weaning of the immunosuppression. They decrease the immunosuppression at 6 months. And then at 12 months, they are off all immunosuppression. So this is a very good dream that after 12 months, it's expected to stop the immunosuppression. And here you see the data of some patients. Five patients achieved zero immunosuppression. 4 patients have achieved 6 months mixed chimerism and weaning. So the list is not very big. But the expected this ongoing study will end by 2022. So let's hope that this will be the final way of stopping immunosuppression after a certain time. Instead of giving a lifelong immunosuppression, maybe after 6 months you start weaning and after 1 year you will stop. If you give this single injection of CD34 plus hematopoietic stem cell and CD3 plus T cell in the Mercury study. Another way of tolerance is giving interleukin 35. Remember the one before was in CD34. Here, now we are interleukin 35. And this Professor Will Birmingham from Wisconsin University is giving interleukin 35, immunosuppressive cytokine composed of EB1 and P35 subunits, assuming its role in infectious tolerance. What is meant by infectious tolerance? It's not an infection. It is suppression of the naive lymphocyte population by cells with regulatory function and the ability to transfer a state of unresponsiveness. It's not an infection. It is transferring the tolerance. This is the definition of it. And you see here that this interleukin 35, ability of the exosomal interleukin 35 to induce interleukin 35 production in conventional TNB cells and to coat bystander lymphocyte, promoting secondary suppression by non-Treg cells, identify a novel mechanism of infectious tolerance. And these are the result of his paper presented in the Congress. So now we have two ways of getting the tolerance. A third way of getting the tolerance is to go nano. And here you go to very small organelles here, which we call them the exosome. Long-term, Dr. Hussein, ممكن انزل اللي فوق ده انزله تحت عشان ايوه ممكن انزل تحت كويس. Long-term allograft survival via donor MHC chimerism induced by exosomes. Exosomes are nanovesicles carrying MHC molecules on their surfaces. هي دي الاكسوزوم الحقيقة. It is 30 to 100 in size. As you see it, it's very small in comparison to this is the size of the cell. And this is the size of the apoptotic body. And this is the size of the microvesicle. You see the exosome is very small. This exosome has got on its surface, I enlarged it. You see the MHC molecules on it. Nanovesicles carrying the MHC molecule on their surface. So exosomes are small extracellular vesicles that are able to transfer surface molecule and antigen from their parent cells. And this study, we investigated whether donor MHC chimerism and allograft tolerance could be achieved via donor exosome injection. هنا هيعملوا ايه؟ هيروحوا, they will give this injection, intravenous dose of purified bone marrow derived exosome, isolated from the donors. They are still speaking about animals. After a month, animal received a skin or an islet allograft. And then when they got this injection, you see here the survival of the skin graft is for those placed 30 days after exosome injection using 10 times less T cell depletion. So بنقارن the green with the red. So the percentage survival in those who in red who got the bone marrow derived exosome, which are 7 animals here, after 200 days is much better than those control or 5 animals who didn't receive the exosome. So this is very important. And in the same time, they measured the donor-specific antibody. And they found that the level of donor-specific antibody in those who got the exosome were much less than those who did not got the exosome. So it seems that this is something very simple to prepare exosome from the purified bone marrow and then inject them into before transplantation or at the time of from the donor and give them. And in this way, can induce long-term survival of skin and islet transplant in place of bone marrow cells to induce allograft survival with minimal conditioning and no risk of graft versus host disease. And if you had the old type, the bone marrow cell, this is the cell. You see here the size of the cell. The problem with cell transfer of bone marrow that there is a risk of graft versus host disease. But when you give this very small molecule, which are the exosome, you don't have this high risk of graft versus host disease. And in the same time, you get long-term skin allograft to 200 days in this experiment and the absence of donor-specific. So you saw now three examples of the tolerance. The first, you see three examples of the tolerance, and I will go to the diagnosing rejection. How to diagnose rejection? I am putting many question marks because this is a very important field carrying much advances. Let's start by subclinical rejection. Always subclinical rejection is a debatable issue. And according to Yale School of Medicine, they do a protocol biopsy every 6 months. And whenever they find a subclinical rejection, they are afraid. because according to the GOCAR study published in 2019, those with subclinical rejection have got a worse graft survival. And according to this protocol biopsy, you see more in a progressive interstitial fibrosis. And according to the American Journal of Transplant publication in 2019, you see higher level of DSA. Higher risk of ongoing to develop clinical acute rejection, more likely to form de novo DSA, more likely to lose the graft at 5 years, more likely to develop IFTA, and more rapid loss of GFR. Therefore, they go whenever they find a borderline rejection. Yeah, we have a debate about to treat or not to treat, but here this is the Yale School of Medicine protocol. Borderline ACR, they give steroid pulse, then taper. BANF1A steroid pulse and taper, BANF1B thymoglobulin, and of course, if it is antibody mediated rejection, they go more aggressive. What about more value of protocol biopsy? Is there a more value for this protocol biopsy that they are doing in Yale, or it is debatable? This study by Mehdi Islami from Innova Fairfax Hospital, he performed 1,000 protocol biopsy. He found in 11 of them borderline rejection, in 23% treatable rejection, and 4.6% complications, 1% only needing hospitalization. And he concluded the utility of protocol biopsy for stable kidney allograft, a significant predictive potential of prior sensitization, and may help elucidate which allograft should undergo biopsy regardless of normal renal function. But the wave now is actually, or the debate is against the value of protocol biopsy, especially in the era of COVID in the United States. They don't like to do much biopsy, and they are trying to embark on more tests to know if there is subclinical rejection or not. How? This less value of protocol biopsy has been raised by the presence of immunological monitoring post-transplantation, a test called the TrueGraf. This TrueGraf, by a company called Transplant Genomic, is a blood gene expression assay approved as an alternative to surveillance biopsy to rule out silent subclinical rejection in patients with stable graft function. It depends on 120 genes. And whenever it is positive, it gives us an idea that there is a subclinical rejection. Also, there is another test which gives an idea not only for not for subclinical rejection, but for established acute allograft injury, which is the presence of donor-derived cell-free DNA. Whenever you find cells from the donor in the recipient, not only the kidney, by the way, it is also for the liver, for the pancreas, and for the heart transplant. When you find cells of the donor in the recipient, it is an indication of presence of rejection. And you should go hard for treatment. And we have you have many companies making this test. Here, there is only the TrueGraf. There is only one company, which is Transplant Genomic. But here, there are around four companies, AlloSure, Track, CareDex. And I will give you a comparison about these tests. So the difference between these two tests, which are nowadays very available and usually practiced. I will give you some example of their practice in the United States. The first test is for subclinical rejection, which is the TrueGraf, 120 genes. And the second test, AlloSure or Track or CareDex, which is the donor-derived cell-free DNA, which is a test of rejection. But the accuracy of this test is below a certain cutoff, is not very accurate for some type of rejection. I will go for this a little bit later on. Let's start in detail by going for this, the TRAC, which is one of the methods of this CC DDCF DNA. the typical report, this is a typical report of a patient. This is the name of the patient. And the report here gives a figure of 0.98 for the track. This 0.98 is a positive test because the typical report should be less than 0.7. So whenever you have a high, this patient have a subclinical rejection. And of course, this is a battle of companies. Here, this is a comparison between the four companies which produce this donor DNA, AlloSure, Prospera, Serasure, and the TRAC. And of course, because this has been met by the TRAC, they are showing that they have better maybe sensitivity or specificity than the others here. But anyhow, you have many ways to do this. What about the subclinical rejection test, the drawbacks for it? Actually, I will give you the experience of the University of Alabama on 116 consecutive kidney transplant recipient, 6 months standard of care surveillance biopsy, and the current COVID pandemic patients are reluctant to come in for biopsy, so they are making this study to show the if the accuracy of for this test. They found a sensitivity of 44%, a specificity of 78%, and these are the data. TrueGraph correctly identified 57 patients here whose biopsy could have been avoided, and correctly identified 8 patients whose biopsy was justified, which is 15 patients would have had a biopsy unnecessary, which are called false positive, and also 10 patients subclinical rejection would have been missed. So, and when they made a survey for the clinician, 3/4 of the clinician, or 2/3 of the clinician, 77%, reported that TrueGraph supported patient management decision, especially in the COVID area, for stable patient, for patient who don't want to do a biopsy, especially if it is a surveillance biopsy. And also the second test, which is this is again the TrueGraph. The second test, which is the, as I told you, the donor-derived DNA. This is patient with new DSA and or elevation in creatinine who are deemed risky to biopsy. So if they find that there is high DSA or elevation in the creatinine, they will perform the test of dd-cf DNA. This test have a lack of sensitivity to BANF borderline and 1A rejection. Yani it's not sensitive in early cases. Yeah. But otherwise, it is a good test and a non-invasive test. So nowadays, you have two practical tests in the United States. And this is the comparison between the two tests. The TrueGraph sensitivity 74, specificity 73 in some papers, and the ddDNA sensitivity 60% and specificity 85% in some papers. Well, their protocol is to use both tests, the TrueGraph for the borderline rejection and donor-derived DNA for the high DSA or established. Another question about the pathology. هي في هجوم على pathology هنا كان في الكونغرس ده three papers. أول واحدة هي اللي فاتت دي اللي هي it's better to do this immunological test instead of protocol biopsy. ثاني هجوم على pathology الحقيقة كان about do they need to do a new BANF classification. الpaper دي by Kelman et al. Has the BANF classification of antibody-mediated rejection changed for the better? Every time the BANF is, we have a new BANF. So they are telling, is the new BANF better than the old BANF? And they concluded that removal of suspicious plus introduction of DSA negative ABMR reduced the prognostic performance in BANF 17. We're reintroducing an intermediate diagnostic category in future BANF updates as clinical relevance. وطبعا يعني كان في بعض الهجوم انه البنف محتاجه تعديل. And another, برضو هجوم على الباثولوجي came from Halloran group, Philip Halloran group from Canada, a paper presented by Kumar about the role of the molecular microscope to guide therapy for T-cell mediated rejection in kidney transplant. هنا بيقول إن الهيستولوجيكال ليجن الـ I plus T to characterize T-cell mediated rejection can be non-specific. In some cases, the inflammation may represent a response to wounding rather than a T-cell recognition. When a molecular microscope could complement histology by identifying TCMR that may not require therapy due to absence of a molecular rejection phenotype. بمعنى انه whenever you are, when he did the survey on many cases, he found that many of the, there was many of the cases زي ما انتم شايفين هنا اللي اتعمل لها histology negative ومولكيولر negative وتريتمنت negative دي prognosis كويس histology positive ومولكيولر negative و no treatment histology positive molecular negative and positive treatment ف there is a group of patient who took treatment according to the positive histology, although the molecular was negative. وبالتالي, if we do this, if we increase the precision of histology, we are avoiding over-treatment. بمعنى, not every patient that is labeled T-cell mediated rejection by simple histology is a candidate for treatment because he may improve by himself if he does not have the pattern of rejection by molecular microscope. So these are the three papers about the pathology. Is there any other way to diagnose the rejection? هي MRI والPET CT بتاعوا يخشوا في كل حاجة. For now we are speaking about non-invasive detection of acute cellular rejection using immunoPET. هنا ابتدوا طبعا التجربة on rats. And this is a rat with a kidney here rejected. And here a kidney which is not rejected for the skin graft as you see here. And using an immunoPET targeting CD122 is specific for acute cellular rejection and correlates with the frequency of the presence of memory T cells. فبالتالي احنا هنستخدم CD122 ونعمل لها utilizing whole body immunoPET imaging targeting CD122 وبالتالي نقدر we can detect if there is rejection or no rejection by simply putting the patient in the PET machine. So this could be a very good idea in the future. The French group are very active in trying to get new molecular signatures of rejection. And Danny Anglicho group from the care hospital is one of the most active in this respect. Where he is not only at the presentation, but he's speaking about blood microRNA for antibody mediated rejection. And one of his young colleagues gave this presentation, Dr. Claire Tinel from his team. وادي التيم نفسه بتاع انجليشو ودي this is a part of a big French study called the Biomargin Consortium اللي هي الكلينيكال ترايل جوفرمنت ده investigated the blood مير اللي هو ام اي ار ان اي او مايكرو ار ان اي مير مي ار ان اي يعني مايكرو ار ان اي ار سمول نون كودنج ار ان اي which regulate the mRNA expression at the post transcriptional level. Non-invasive biomarker in kidney transplant. We بعد ما خدوا blood samples collected at time of 717 renal allograft biopsy in four European transplant centers. The primary endpoint was the diagnostic accuracy of all these multiple MIR RNA biomarker. وقالوا أنهي البيومركر of rejection. They concluded that there are 14 of them which are usually affected in rejection, 14. And out of these 14, they found only three differential diagnoses for 14 miRNA intersect with the transcriptomic data. These 14 regulated up to 45% of the most increased genes in ABMR. Like in a short three of them, 15, 106, with 374. I'll tell you the numbers. Three signature yielded an area under the curve of 70.4. لما حطينا عليهم البروتينوريا والدونر سبيسيفيك انتي بودي this increased the diagnosis from 70.4 to 85.3 يعني it increased only by 15%. So if you have these three miRNA 15 106 and 374 you are sure that you are safe and your expression and you have confirmed to be an antibody mediated rejection. Yeah, that advanced quite early if it could be applied in the future. Our data provide new insight of this miRNA as biomarkers. The link between the monocyte response, then this miRNA, sabatin here are coming from the monocyte, the blood, and their infiltrating property in the allograft could provide new insight to pathological mechanism in antibody-mediated rejection. طبعاً, whenever we are speaking about immunological tests, we cannot forget Professor Mini Serwal. Mini Serwal came to Egypt last year, and her work in San Francisco is very respected. طبعاً, she will not leave this era of immune markers or biomarkers without a new publication with Flavio Vincenti in this American Transplant Congress. And their publication here this time was about a urine Q score or quiescent score. This is a non-invasive, accurate diagnosis and prediction of kidney transplant rejection by using six markers. And استخدم six things. Urinary DNA protein, six urinary DNA protein and metabolic biomarker, cfDNA, with mcfDNA, clusterine, creatinine, total protein, and the chemokine number 10, CXCL10. Them were measured in urine. So it's a simple test. Through a comparison that a urinary composite of this Q-score enabled diagnosis of acute rejection with an area under the curve of 0.9. The Q-score was highest in acute rejection, lowest in stable patient, and intermediate with borderline acute rejection, زي ما باين في figure G. وبالتالي, this could be, if you get these six tests together, you can have, in a very nice way, a diagnosis reaching sometimes 100 specificity, as you see here, in these tests. Another, the problem, as a question, what about the cost of these tests? الحقيقة, this paper is addressing, is coming from Boston, from Harvard again, Brigham's Women's Hospital, addressing a very cheap test. They are telling it is a cheap test. I did not ask about the price, but they are telling it is a cheap test, only using detecting a sort of specific high sensitivity enzymatic reporter. We detect the BK virus with CMV, with the chemokine, number 9. فزي strip كده وهذا strip will tell us if there is rejection or no rejection. For both CMV and BK virus detection in urine and blood, we had very high sensitivity and compared with the gold standard. وكذلك المونيتورينج of CX9, chemokine 9 in urine, constitutes a promising technique for the detection of rejection. Persistent elevation after treatment can also be an indicator of resistant rejection. في بقى ratio between الكيموكاين 10 والكرياتينين. A ratio between the urine creatinine, the urine chemokine and the creatinine, monitoring in pediatric kidney transplant. This test, multi-center prospective cohort study on 97 patients, تاخد منهم more than 1,000 urine sample, 240 biopsy sample, where they found that this urine chemokine 10 over the creatinine reproducibly define a low threshold that may avoid surveillance biopsy with a high sensitivity and a high threshold to indicate biopsy with high specificity. وبالتالي, it's a good test in the future also. بعد كده, بالنسبة بما أننا سيرة viral infection في السلايد اللي فات, وقلنا إن إحنا we can detect by this sheep test the presence of CMV. We will add a comment about the treatment of CMV with this letermovir, and a drug that could be used for resistance, intolerance, preference for oral therapy, or refractory CMV. But take care that the count of the viruses, the viral load, should be less than 1,000 per national unit per million. And if you have a low viral load, you can give this drug, letermovir. But if it is more than 1,000, this drug will not be very effective. So these are the conclusion. Used for established CMV infection, which is a step down therapy after achieving a low level viremia, which with relatively good term outcome. Future study should address combination therapy with other drugs. What about the risk of TB in kidney transplantation recipient compared to dialysis patients? This study in more than 11,000 transplant and 11,000 end-stage renal disease and healthy control groups, 11,000 Bardo, they found that they got 161 TB in those 11,000, 154 in the dialysis population and 46 only in the normal population. وبالتالي, a risk of TB was significantly increased in the kidney transplant, تقريبا الدبل, أكثر من الدبل, 2.3, وكذلك في الاند ستيج رينال ديزيز, بس بين الترانسبلانت, between the transplant and the end stage renal disease, there was no difference in the TB risk. The risk is increasing with old age, male sex, and diabetes. Are there any better way for improving the match of our patient than the HLA mismatch? Yes, there are immune mechanisms more complicated than the HLA mismatch. We know that the HLA mismatch has been used for many, many years to select our transplant cases. And nowadays, we are speaking about more refinement of this, but what we call the epitopes and the applet match. This epitope and applet match gives us a better result. Three studies coming from different places in the world, one from the United States, one from Japan, and one from Europe, speaking about the applet match in transplantation. Let's start by the Japanese study, clinical significance of T cell and B cell epitope prediction as a risk factor of de novo DSA production after kidney transplant. And we'll see here that applet mismatch of 1-13 have a good prognosis, but if you have a mismatch between 14 and 67, there is a bad prognosis. So if you have a high applet mismatch, you have a bad prognosis. This is the Japanese study. This is the European study. Again, you see that maybe this curve is easier. A matchmaker more than 36 carries a poor prognosis, and a matchmaker less than 5 carries a good prognosis, and in between you have the result. And this is the paper coming from Emory University from the United States. Again, they are not only doing applet match, DQ. As you know, the DQ antigen frequency among donor and recipient, they found that DQ3 antigen is present in 1/3 of their cases. Yeah, this is coming from Emory University, and they found a very interesting finding that is going with the racial war that we are seeing in the United States nowadays. The de novo DSA that developed in our pediatric renal transplant patients, where DQ3 antigen, where to DQ3 antigen. Importantly, they found that the African American expressed the DQ3 antigen significantly less than the Caucasian. يعني دول عندهم DQ3 and the Caucasian don't have. An unanticipated observation that to our knowledge has not been previously reported. This is the first time that they reported it. Thus, when an African American recipient is paired with a Caucasian donor, there will be a higher probability of DQ3 antigen mismatch. وبالتالي the development of the novel DQ3 donor specific. For that one, I leave a question mark about this DQ3 mismatch between African American and Caucasian. Well, and we don't want to throw more oil on the fire. Now, I will be speaking about the next epitope study coming from the United States. Hey, guy, I'm in Henry Ford from Detroit. Detroit Henry Ford Center. Epitope mismatch load enough to identify, is it enough to identify HLA-DQ mismatch with a low risk for de novo DSA development? And they concluded in their study that HLA-DQ mismatch, لما نحط معاه الإبيتوب, أكيد النتائج بتبقى better, لأنه with zero epitope mismatch يختلف عن إن الإبيتوب mismatch أكثر من zero. Significantly less donor-specific antibody عن لو عملت معاه more than epitope mismatch more than I will take a break and ready for questions before going to the FIPS part.
Yes, thank you very much, Professor Hany, for your hard efforts. Dr. Yasser Hamid raised his hand, so start with Dr. Yasser.
Fadal, Dr. Yasser.
Yes, Dr. Yasser Bash. Unmute. Yes, Dr. Yasser, تفضل.
Thank you, Professor Hany, for this elegant talk. Okay.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you. Very informative. My question about the markers in acute antibody-mediated rejection.
Yes.
These markers are for only diagnosis. Do you have any other markers or any methods, especially radiological methods, to detect other data in biopsy, such as, for example, the fibrosis, degree of fibrosis, or something like this, especially radiological imaging?
Thank you very much for your question. طبعاً, of course, الادفانتج الحقيقة اللي هي ما زالت في البيوبسي حتى الآن إن هي زي ما حضرتك تفضلت اللي هو الفايبروزز وكده is still present. لكن هو في ماركرز الحقيقة للحاجات اللي الفايبروزز زي الجوكار ستادي اللي هي كانت اتنشرت يمكن حوالي few years كانت مبينة إن في يعني ماركرز معينة ممكن تتقاس مش كتير منها of academic interest أكتر منها of practical interest بحيث إن هي ممكن to detect the presence of fibrosis in the graft يعني في حاجات كتيرة بتعلى وغالبا مع ال development بتاع التست الجديدة دي لازم هيبقى فيه more sensitivity بحيث إن هما they will try to differentiate between the different causes of graft dysfunction. هل هو progressive fibrosis ولا في infection ولا في rejection ولا يعني the different causes will be discriminated by different tests.
لو سمحت دكتور هاني وبالنسبة للMRI for the MRI there are many advances in MRI to diagnose fibrosis. Especially if fibrosis is more than 25% or 50%. There is a good correlation as shown in one of the papers. Here at Urology and First Center, the radiologists tried to convince us by the role of radiology all through the years, Doppler, CT, MRI, but up to this moment, we don't believe 100% in radiology, and the gold standard test is still unfortunately, the biopsy invasive maneuver, and even the for my point of view regarding the biomarkers, we are dream in a dream, and we hope that certain time we'll find a magic biomarker to replace the majority of invasive tests. But up to this moment, I think biopsy is still needed, and surveillance biopsy is good tool to assess inflammation and to diagnose subclinical rejection. Yes, in COVID, we can be reluctant for biopsy, but I think after COVID, biopsy is still a good weapon to diagnose the rejection and to categorize the risk of the graft loss in the future. Regarding one of the very nice tests you mentioned, that it seems that it is very interesting, which is AlloSure, or circulating free donor-derived DNA in the serum blood, in the blood of the recipient. It is high at the time of transplantation, but after that it drops to a very low level, and then it increases with any episodes of rejection, especially antibody-mediated rejection. This is, as you mentioned, in your presentation. And one of advantages that I like, if we treat antibody-mediated rejection by aggressive IVIG plasma exchange and the creatinine is still high, is it because of persistence of antibody-mediated phenomena or damage resulted from antibody-mediated rejection? If we repeat AlloSure testing and we find circulating free DNA is reduced after treating rejection, so this is the consequences of damage rather than continued antibody process, and this will allow us to reduce the over-immune suppression for the patient. All these tests are fantastic, but the problem is predictability and reproducibility, and they still need validation. Dr. Yasser, fadl.
This is my second question. هل البيوماركرز ليها prognostic criteria data, يعني ممكن تديني prognostic data, not just diagnostic at a time point? This is acute antibody rejection. بتالي حضرتك جاوبت دلوقتي
دكتور هاني. في بعضهم طبعا بيديك long term prognosis, يعني بتشوف الدنيا ماشيه ازاي بعدين, وبعدين زي ما دكتور حسين تفضل, they could be repeated more than once to see if there is improvement in the condition or not. والحقيقه many of these are coming to our countries. يعني I think that the true graph and the donor derived DNA will soon be available again. Also the urinary chemokines will be definitely coming very soon. يعني دي كلها not very difficult tests, يعني to be applied. وزي ما انا قلت بعضهم they are telling ان في deep sticks بتبين الفيروسز, وبقت حاجه شيب, يعني مش حاجه صعبه في الدياجنوز.
يا ريت. شكرا لحضرتك.
شكرا. Let's move to the third the fifth part of my talk. معلش طولت عليكم يعني, بس هو المؤتمر كان كبير الحقيقه.
لا, الحاجه اللي انا عاوز اقولها قبل ما حضرتك تبروسيد, يعني ده فعلا موهبه وتالنت تو فولو وبيشنس, ديجري اوف بيشنس يعني عاليه جدا جدا جدا, ان حضرتك توليريت تو ليسن تو ذيس برزنتيشن بيكوز اتس فيري ديفيكولت تو جراسب ا مسج, بس ما شاء الله يعني ذا مسج.
ثانك يو حسين. ثانك يو يا حبيبي. ناو ليتس جو تو ذا fifth part of my presentation, which is immunosuppression and desensitization. Of course, طبعا البارت ده يمكن بيبقى more appealing للنفرولوجيست, لان احنا whenever we have for example a case of antibody mediated rejection, في potential therapies that we are using, plasmapheresis, immunoadsorption, intravenous immunoglobulin, going to anti-CD20, whether the first generation rituximab or the second generation, زي الأوبينيتوزيماب. في trials للuse of the belumumab that I will speak about, هنشوف الstudies بتاعتها. Trial للC1 esterase inhibitor, هنشوفها برضو. Interleukin-6 inhibitor, في many studies about التوسيروزيماب, الأكتمرا اللي هو خد شهرة بعد استخدامه في الكوفيد nowadays. وstudies about الجلازاكيزوماب. كل دي من البوتنشال ways for using inactive or acute antibody rejection. Unfortunately, chronic active antibody, chronic rejection, the results فيها ما زالت poor. يعني ما فيش في significant comorbidity وما فيش فيها advances كثيرة قوي في research. On the other hand, بالنسبة للimmunosuppression in general, في طبعا تقدم في منطقة الكوستيميليشن بلوكيد. يمكن دي أنا قلت الأنتي سي دي 40 جبت سيرته في الأول خالص, وأنا when I was speaking about the stem cell trial اللي بتبتدي تدي أنتي سي دي 40 في البدايات وفي الزينو ترانسبلانتيشن. وفي برضه some advances في البروتيازوم inhibitor, بس usually they give it in combination with the costimulation blockade, يعني الكارفيلزوميب أو البورتيزوميب. في some advances في السيلولر ثيرابي. وطبعا في الوان ستادي وفي التاسك ستادي اونجوين وفي الايدس جبنا سيرته واحنا بنتكلم على السبليتنج بتاع الاندوبيبتيديز هيموجلوبين جي which is derived from the streptococcus pyogenes with cleavable anti-HLA antibody. فيمكن ده استعراض عام وهنبتدي نتكلم على بعض البيبرز or presentation that has been in the American Transplant Congress addressing these immunosuppression diseases. Let's embark and start. يمكن أول واحدة غريبة شوية. أنا بعتبر غريبة لأنه في الوقت اللي الإيبو بيضاي في العالم while the EPO is decreasing in use in the world with the rise of new agents for treatment of anemia, now they are trying to find a role for the EPO in transplantation. And they are telling in some papers, you can see two papers that are about EPO decreases a donor-specific antibody. And this is one of them. Erythropoietin reduces alloantibody formation by inhibiting T follicular helper cells. دي جاية من إيطاليا الحقيقة وبتقول إنه الإيبو بيلمت الـ DSAction by directly inhibiting the B cells versus inhibiting the TFH cells. وهاي دوز erythropoietin treatment with anti-CD8 monoclonal antibody may substitute for kidney co-transplantation. يعني عندهم two arms. واحد بيدو كيدني مع هارت اللي هي بيسموها كو ترانسبلانتيشن، واحد بيدو ايبو مع الهارت ترانسبلانتيشن، ولقوا النتائج الاثنين زي بعض. يعني ان لو ادوا ايبو اتس لايك اف ذا جيف ذا كيدني. فيعني ذير از ا داوت في الكلام ده لغايه ما يبقى بروفن ان اذر ستاد، لكن الايبو لاقي سكته. تاني الحقيقه جروب هو البيست ترايل. احنا طول عمرنا عارفين البيلاتاسبت اول ما طلع we have in 2009 and 10 we got the benefit and the benefit x. 2011 we got the Ferguson et al publication. In 2016 and 17 we got the benefit and benefit x يعني more years follow up. و 2020 طلع البيست ترايل، هي دي الجديده اللي هي اختصارها بيلاتاسبت بيست ريجيمن بيلاتاسبت early steroid withdrawal trial أو best trial. إن البيلاتاسبت is a good agent to make early withdrawal of steroid. الحقيقة هي بصفة عامة الترايل دي compared to بيلاتاسبت based regimen. واحد بيدي alemtuzumab or ATG induction with a tacrolimus based regimen. يعني التاكرولمس based regimen اللي هو الأحمر ده ATG مع التاكرولمس، والاثنين دول بيلاتاسبت الأزرق والأخضر the green and the blue both of them are بيلاتاسبت. One بيلاتاسبت plus ATG and one بيلاتاسبت plus campus. And they are stopping the steroid early. The purpose of this study was to compare the impact of rejection on renal function in bila treated patient versus tac treated patient. الحقيقة زي ما انتم شايفين the proportion free from biopsy proven acute rejection هتبقى after 24 months more biopsy proven rejection in both the bila arms. يعني both bila arms فيهم more acute rejection. عن الايه عن التاكرولمس. فيعني النتيجه ما كانتش جميله قوي زي ما انتم شايفين. This is the best trial. The absolute increase in rejection incidence between bila and CNI arms was similar to those reported in benefit between bila and cyclosporin. الجديد الحقيقه في البيست انه استخدم التاكرولمس ما استخدمش بقى cyclosporin زي ما كانوا في البنفيت. TAC was associated with lower rates of rejection. Rejection was associated with worse renal function regardless of the regimen. الحقيقة يعني ما كانش النتائج بتاعة البيلا أرم هايلة. طيب. Another برضو محاولة لإنقاذ هذه البيلا تثبت based early steroid withdrawal بأنه جماعة بتوع السايكولوجي يشوفوا إذا كان الـ patient reported outcome in a prospective multi-center trial of BILA-based CNI and corticosteroid-free immunosuppression. يعني they gave a questionnaire for the patient across 8 sites وكل الـ patient بيسألوهم are you happy, quality of life عن طريق 2 tests. التست الأولاني اسمه Memphis والتست الثاني اسمه MTSOSD59R. فتعالوا نشوف التو تيست دول. ده المنفيس سيرفي بتسأل فيه الايموشنال بيردن، اللايف رول ريسبونسابيلتي، الجي اي تي ديستريس، الموبيليتي والميسيلينيا سايد افكت. يعني في 5 ماركرز. وده الام تي اس او اس تيست برضه بيتسأل في بوينتس معينه validated self report scale assess the presence and distress of side effects ودي ال detailed results between the arm of the bila and the arm with without bila. A conclusion: CNI free bila based regimen resulted in a tendency toward improved across 2 years, and the general condition of the patient was better, maybe because they get less injections. But the psychological symptom, the restlessness, the anxiety, the mood changes, were higher in the bila-based regimen. وكذلك sores on lips and warts on hands and feet were more frequently in the bila-based regimen 2 years, which may be related to increased viral infection. في نفس الوقت النيورولوجيكال سيمتومز زي التريمورز والجي اي تي والموبيليتي سيمتومز were more reported in the tacrolimus based regimen. يعني conclusion بتاعت البست لغايه دلوقتي انه الريجكشن كانت اكتر في البيلا ارم وانه السايكولوجي والوورتس كانت اكتر في البيلا ارم وانه ستيل الكالسينيورين انهيبيتور يعني ليها رول. What about the third paper about BAF inhibition? We gave the series of belumumab, and you know that belumumab or BAF inhibitor to prevent antibody rebound following proteasome inhibitor-based desensitization. A randomized controlled trial, جاية من Cincinnati, Ohio, ودي الحقيقة اتنشرت برضو في American Journal of Transplant 2020. They noticed that whenever you give these proteasome inhibitor, say bortezomib or carfilzomib, there is decrease, then again increase rebound of زي ما انتم شايفين هنا level, sorry, MFI بينزل وبعدين يرجع يعلى تاني. يعني there is decrease in the MFI, then there is increase in the MFI again when you stop. But they tried to decrease this rebound by giving another drug, and this drug is the belumumab or the BAF inhibitor. So the purpose of the study reduces the bone marrow plasma cells. Proteasome inhibitor reduces the bone marrow plasma cells and the HLA antibody in renal transplant can. However, rebound is common in many patients. Increase in the BAF level occur after B cell depletion, and maybe an important mechanism which may be reduced by belumumab or the BAF inhibitor. الميزه بتاعت البيلوموماب انه خد FDA approval for lupus before and it will humanized IgG monoclonal antibody against the soluble BAF. وده الديزاين اوف ذا ستادي الحقيقه هم هنا استخدموا they used these are the data of 6 patients as you see randomized open label control trial dual center. الانترفنشن هيدوا الستاندرد اوف كير بلس البيلوموماب او يدوا البورتيزوميب من غير ما يدوا بيلوموماب. الاربع عيانين دول the four patients who got بيلوموماب and بورتيزوميب together, this one patient, second patient, third patient and fourth patient, you see that those who got the بورتيزوميب there is a increase of the antibody after stopping the drug. يعني هنا البورتيزوميب has been stopped and there is increase in the antibody. While if you give belumumab, there is decrease in the antibody and it remained decreased. Here also it decreased in the antibody and it remained decreased. So هو ده نجح في ان هو يمينتين الدروب. All patients received 2 cycles of bortezomib with plasma ferrites before the first and fourth dose of each cycle. In group A, no additional treatment was administered. While in group B, patient received ipilimumab, 10 milligram per kg. كملوا تاني. They gave different doses on different days. They were given on day 0, 10, 28, 37, 65, 94, and 121. Primary endpoint were safety and reduction in the immunodominant antibody, it will be some I antibody, measured by single antigen. So it seems that this double combination, lower the proteasome inhibitor, or bortezomib, plus the BAF, or the belumumab, we maintain the I antibody, what بالتالي بيبقى more effective. Belumumab therapy was well tolerated in all patients having a reduction in the I antibody. 6 patients reached primary endpoint. 2 out of 4 receiving had substantial long-term suppression of this low antibody. Trial 4, treatment of antibody-mediated rejection بلاتاسبت مع الكارفيزوميب. أنا قلت لكم usually they combine the بلاتاسبت الكوستيميليشن بلوكيد, they combine it with the proteasome. The proteasome alone is weak. زي ما احنا شفنا in the previous study, بيحصل فيه rebound. لكن when they combined it with belatacept, they maintain a better level of circulating TH cells or circulating plasma cells and serum creatinine post giving. هنا طبعا بيدوا للانيمالز للمونكيز وبتبقى maintained versus other desensitization combining co-stimulation blockade with proteasome inhibitor in highly sensitized transplant candidate. All DSA reduced with BILA proteasome inhibitor desensitization prior to transplantation. There is a sustained DSA suppression post-transplantation with no AMR or ACR for a long period. In 3 patients, Canada, 1 patient, 2 patients, and 3 cases, حصل فيهم maintenance for a long period بالcombination. The 5th study, synergistic effect of donor and recipient intervention. هنا هيستخدموا C1 esterase inhibitor. C1 esterase inhibitor prevents delayed graft function and improves antibody-mediated rejection-free survival after kidney allotransplantation in non-human primate. وطبعا in this study they proved that the concept اللي هو قبل كده has been proven by the French group Glotz and Lefaucher that the C1 inhibitor in acute antibody mediated rejection non-responsive to conventional therapy كان استخدموا C1 esterase added to IVIG and they found it is safe and may improve allograft function in kidney recipient with non-responsive acute antibody mediated rejection. أما الحقيقة in that study which was not a very big study الحقيقة هم كانوا بيستخدموا it has been done on 6 patients yeah. As I remember it was not a big study but in the primary endpoint April 2013 and July 2014 and received C1 INH and IVIG for 6 months in 6 patients. The primary endpoint was the change on GFR at 6 months after inclusion. The secondary endpoint included the change in histology with donor-specific antibody and adverse events as evaluated for months number 6. زي ما حضراتكم شايفين, the primary EGFR and secondary endpoint كان the protocol biopsy with anti-HLA DSA with safety. والدواء اسمه برينيرت اللي هو C1 inhibitor. بيتاخد 20 international unit per kg في day 1 و day 2 و day 3 and twice weekly مع ال IVIG 2 gram per kg every 4 weeks every month. والحقيقة النتائج بتاعة ال 6 patients بعد 6 months كانت نتائج جيدة regarding the GFR and regarding the markers of rejection. The 6th drug, the 6th study that I will speak about, as you know, اللي هي الكلازاكيزوماب. The study D has been launched long ago. We expected to be completed the trial in August 2020, and لسه recruiting cases we followed. In the late antibody mediated rejection study protocol of a randomized controlled pilot study, where النتائج بتاعتها probably the interleukin 6 inhibitor are very promising in the antibody عرف سنة ولا كمل basic advances هكمل البيزك advances بقى البيزك advances الحقيقة هتكلم على donor risk على recurrence هتكلم على الاميونوميتر على الاميون ميموري واتكلم على الميكانيزم of rejection let's start by the donor risk الحقيقة هنا هبين صورة لواحد بحبه جدا اللي هو الدكتور كريم مجدي سليمان I was very happy to hear him giving a plenary, one of the plenaries, the 14 plenary اللي اتقدموا من young doctors, فكان كريم سليمان one of them. بيقدم additive effect of obesity to hypertension in living donors and their impact on glomerular filtration rate compensation with 5-year follow-up. حقيقة وراجع الداتا بتاعت اليونس لحوالي 130,000 donors 2,285 had hypertension, around 60% were female, we around 34,000 plus had were obese, had BMI more than 30 kilograms. We can study the target بتاعها, the follow-up of those donors to see if there is hypertension alone is a risk, and obesity alone is also a risk. If we add both risks together, based on pre-donation diagnosis, donors were divided into two groups, hypertensive and non-hypertensive, and groups were further stratified according to their body mass index into less than 30 and more than 30 kilograms per meter squared. The conclusion of the study by Dr. Karim, among those with age less than 50 years, pre-existing hypertension هيزود a major 24-fold increase the risk of no GFR compensation. يعني هيعطل ال compensation بتاع GFR 24 time in response لل odds ratio can to 24.2. Among hypertensive donor with BMI more than 30, the risk increased further by 2.8-fold. يعني severity of hypertension لما نزود عليها الobesity هيبقى فيه more risk. So both hypertension and obesity have major adverse impact on compensatory GFR. The additive effect of these should be well understood when counseling. لازم نقول للعيانين you have a real risk if you are obese to be a donor. And therefore the question to Dr. Karim بعد المحاضرة بتاعته كانت يا ترى نask for a bariatric surgery before donation yes or no. His answer, yes, he told, yes, it's better. Yunus data analysis, you don't have follow-up, BMI at time of donation. 7% increased overall risk. No center will accept the proteinuria. Maybe the patient had the proteinuria from the obesity. His answer was, no center will accept proteinuria. So these patients were not obese with kidney disease. And they were not proteinuric. And last question, what do you do in your center? Counseling donors who are hypertensive and obese above 33 to 35 BMI, contraindicated, hypertension repeat 24 hours monitoring and exclude and terrify the donors. هنا كانت بالنسبة للبرياتريك سيرجري بما أنها اتقالت ففي there were two publications, one in the about obese liver transplant and the other was about obese kidney transplant. I will put the obese liver transplant. Here you see the difference in prognosis. Mean years of survival following weight loss intervention, BMI sensitivity analysis, post-transplant sleeve or pre-transplant sleeve. But of course, pre-transplant sleeve is better, much better, survival from the start of intervention. There is a very big difference between a pre-transplant. So if you want to do it pre. Sleeve gastrectomy, transplant had a higher rate and had a mean survivor of 2.6 years higher than if you do post-transplant sleeve gastrectomy. So obese while in the wait list should be offered a sleeve gastrectomy. Another important aspect, recurrence of the original kidney disease. I will just give an example of the studies about recurrence. by giving this tango study. Tango, يمكن لطيفة أننا نتكلم عن التانجو, بس التانجو الحقيقة هي اسمها Post Transplant Glomerular Disease Project. هو داخل الاختصار بتاعها تانجو. It's a multi-center study. وطبعا لازم تكون في تانجو جاي من ساوث امريكا, فلازم تكون ساوث امريكا موجوده فيهم 15 تانجو ستادي سنتر, واليوروب والنورث امريكا. They follow patients who are transplanted for 10 years from 2005 to 2015 with حوالي 12,000 patient, وبيشوفوا البوست ترانسبلانت glomerular disease عندهم recurrence هيحصل فيه. They found إنه بالنسبة لل IgA nephropathy at present 360 patients were included. They found that 20% حصل لهم recurrence up till now, but fortunately 4% only of this total cohort lost their graft due to recurrent IgA nephropathy. هذه inclusion data collection will end in January 2020. We'll find an analysis of the tango will be probably next year. So the conclusion, IgA recur in 20%, but only in 4% it will lead to dysfunction, severe dysfunction, or end stage renal disease. What about immunometer? All the time we are trying to adjust our immunosuppression by some markers. Marina على many tests that are claiming that they are the immunometer. And one of these tests here, اللي هو الIVIST trial, a multi-center randomized control trial to steer immunosuppressive therapy by virus-specific T cells after pediatric kidney transplantation. يعني هيقيسوا الvirus-specific T cells. This study is coming from Germany, from Hanover, by Dr. Thorid Gruneau from Hanover. هتحاول تشوف الفيرال سبيسيفيك تي سيلز اللي هم بيختصروا الى تي فيس ريبريزنت الاوفرول ستيت اوف اميونيتي. الهايبوثيسيس هنا بتاعت الاستادي انه اديشنال ستيرنج باي تي فيس ليفل مي اوبتمايز ذا دوزنج اوف اميونوسبريسيف دراج, وبالتالي بنقدر نعرف ستابيلايزيشن اوف ذا جرافت فانكشن, لوور اكسبوجر تو اميونوسبريسيف دراجز, tendency of less acute rejections with tendency for less EB viremia. بمعنى انه when we measure this TVIS, we can see if we are over immunosuppressing our patient or under immunosuppressive our patient. حقيقة في in this study, they multi-center randomized to steer immunosuppressive therapy by monitoring virus-specific CD4 T cells against the CMV will herpes, will adenovirus after pediatric kidney transplantation. We be follow up to 2 years, right, months 24. We be randomized, investigator-initiated multicenter prospective trial, 64 pediatric kidney recipients were randomized 4 weeks after transplantation, either to a non-intervention group with classical trough level monitoring of the immunosuppression, or intervention group with additional steering by the T virus TVS level. This means in case of low CD4, يعني لو لقينا low CD4 virus specific cells, the dose of immunosuppressant is decreased. يعني we will readjust the dose of immunosuppression according to what comes from the TVS, not from the level of the drug. They found هنا acute rejection proven by biopsy or cause. The time to first acute rejection, including borderline, there was a difference between the intervention group and the control group. And those patients who were adjusted immunosuppressive, their immunosuppression were adjusted by the TVS, has got a better survival. The intervention in red, they have got a better survival at 24 months. Those who were given blindly, the immunosuppression is just monitoring of the drug level, they got a worse level. So this is a very important message that stabilization of the graft, lower exposure, tendency of less acute rejection, and tendency of less EBV viremia by using this TVS. So maybe we have a new immunometer that is coming. additional steering of immunosuppressive therapy by TVS level is safe and personalizes the immunosuppressive therapy by reducing exposure to immunosuppressant, resulting in stabilization of EGF. Another study is coming from, Philippe Halloran from Canada. They're comparing the overall temporal gene expression between different transplants, the kidney, the heart, the liver, the lung biopsy. We know that interliver, interlung, intercomex, interheart study groups. We know that there are differences between the different organs regarding immunogenicity and regarding the stability of the graft and the time of rejection. And they found فعلاً in all markers of temporal gene expression is different between the different organs. Can see around 3,000 kidney once and less heart, around 400 liver, and they found, and these are the data. Liver early rejection, but late stability, lung airway mucosal biopsy, late rejection, like changes. So we can it curves that Philip. What about the immune memory? Memory CD cells purified from 8-hour heart allograft, 40 hour after transplant, expressed high level of CD25 and CD122, but not CD127 transcript. Here can it the study again from Cleveland Clinic. We another study memory T cells in mouse renal transplantation from Pittsburgh graft T resident memory cells cause rejection. A third study coming here, CD8 T cell expression of FCGR2B is associated with freedom from rejection following tacrolimus withdrawal in the CTOT trial. You remember the CTOT trial was a trial of stopping CTOT9, stopping the tacrolimus in stable patients, and it has been stopped prematurely because when you stop the drug without a marker of يعني proper immune state, you got rejection. They studied the patient that got rejection in this study when they stopped the tacrolimus, and they found that some of these patients, they got those who got CD8 plus T cell were associated with freedom from rejection. So this is a way. Then there was a very interesting debate between Fadi Lakas and another professor about how donor an antibody mediated rejection, how DSA is a cause or a bystander. Maybe somebody will ask, is it an academic issue? No, it's not an academic issue. No, it will affect in the future the selection of drug. If it is a cause, it is important to find a drug for it. If it is a bystander, it is not very important, and let's go to see the mechanism. فابتدى الحقيقة, the opponent, by telling that it is a cause, that DSA could be a cause, and Paul Terazaki giving the significance of a positive cross-match test and antibody, and he put many publications about antibody-induced vascular inflammation, screws infiltrating macrophage to enable remodeling phenotype in a model of transplant rejection. He also reviewed a paper by Alexander Lupi and Carmen Lefaucher, published 2 years ago in New England Journal of Medicine, telling that the antibody-mediated rejection of solid organ, not only the kidney, but also the heart and the lungs, are all mediated by these antibodies, as you see in this cartoon. And also, he gave many evidence, sorry for the quality of the test, evidence from literature of a causative role, and strength association and independence of effect have been reproduced with consistency in the studies. Complement-dependent cross-matching that avoids cytotoxic donor-specific antibodies has dramatically reduced the occurrence of acute antibody-mediated rejection. وكان في experimental evidence وفي time evidence والبيولوجيكال gradient والcoherence والanalogy. كل دي كانت evidence for it is a cause. وبالتالي his conclusion was the following: DSA must be present in every case of ABMR. Up to 90% have detectable DSA in the circulation, have been isolated from rejecting allograft and their donor specificity confirmed. Mice given pure DSA and lacking other element of the adaptive immune system, gilhum antibody mediated rejection. But the DSA must be recoverable from the experimental host. DSA has been recovered in the circulation in the mice given DSA causing C4D deposition in the graft. On the other hand, in Barra, Dr. Fadi Lakas, يدافع ويقول no, antibody, ال DSA is a simple bystander. واستعان الحقيقة بالتاريخ, he got to Claude Bernard and Robert Koch. لأنه Claude Bernard قال a problem of causation, proof and counterproof. Proof that a given condition always precedes or accompanies a phenomenon does not warrant concluding with certainty that a given condition is the immediate cause of that phenomenon. It must still be established that when the condition is removed, the phenomenon will no longer appear. كلام Claude Bernard. كلام Robert Koch. He is telling that if you find that a broken window in your house, you see a broken window, if you throw a baseball at the window, it will break the window. This does not necessarily mean that a ball broke the window. You are looking at now, especially when there is no ball at the scene. And the ball is present in the neighborhood only 50% of the time. Something else may have broken the window and the ball is here. And maybe this is the postulation of Robert Koch. It could be present, but it is not the cause. This is what Fadi Lakas is telling. Also, he is referring to many other publications. In the Banff classification, there is no... None of them include the causative agent antibody in the tissue. Circulating DSA, the presumed causative agent, is not a must in the publication. DSA, the presumed causative agent, is often absent, and many patients with DSA do not have rejection. The DSA assay has important caveats. Detects antibody against denatured HLA molecule falsely. Most cases of DSA ممكن يبقى معاها microvascular inflammation. والحاجة the other cause is that there are, according to Fadi Lakas' publication in Science Immunology in 2017, there are many innate immunity factor to allogenic graft, like here, you see the dendritic cells and other cells. So there are the presence of the rejection is multifactorial and it is not only caused by the DSA. So this is the defense of Fadi Lakas. So if it is not DSA, the cause of the graft deterioration, theoretically, what is the driving long-term cause for graft loss? And let's see some papers dealing with this. If it is not DSA alone, what are other causes? We will find this publication that single cell RNA sequencing of normal kidney allograft surveillance biopsy show evidence of dynamic glomerular endothelial cell activation. Now we are assuming that the glomerular endothelial cell activation is an important cause for this graft deterioration. And you see in this publication, old publication also, the podocyte depletion hypothesis in the allograft, that they found that first year rate of podocyte detachment is the strongest predictor of graft loss at median 4.5 year during the first post-transplant year. When a few microcirculation injury as a major determinant of late kidney allograft failure. In this study, in his current study, عملوا pre-perfusion biopsy, 3 months biopsy, 12 months biopsy for 7 cases. And these are the graphs they found. They found a cellular response to VEGF angiogenesis they studied also the glomerular endothelial cells. And they found that there is a difference between the old and the young regarding the VEGF. And they postulated that this difference between the old and the young could be a cause of the senescence or the deterioration of the graft. So what is driving long-term graft loss could be accelerated aging or senescence through this VEGF. It could be through podocyte detachment, because all these cases had not got any significant proteinuria and had normal serum creatinine. And they found in decanatal presentation, one of the plenary presentation, they found ligands for the VEGF R1, receptor 1 and receptor 2 in the glomerular epithelial cells. And they found the podocytes and the mesangial cells. And the summary of the study is, we identified increased expression of genes associated with angiogenesis, as well as marker of endothelial stress, even in histologically normal allografts, and this may explain the subclinical rejection in a way. There was a corresponding increase in their ligands in the podocytes and mesangium. These data are compatible with dynamic glomerular endothelial cell activation in kidney transplant, pathways that are known to drive glomerular disease progression. And the future direction is to define more the role of podocyte with mesangial cells and the VEGFR axis. More mechanisms of rejection, the microbiome. معنا دكتور طارق الباز. فطبعا كان في some publication about microbiome affects transplant outcome. This one study from that group by Martin et al. And another study got restricted. SVB is sufficient to accelerate skin graft rejection, another mechanism of rejection. Another mechanism of rejection is the ischemia reperfusion injury. We know that ischemia and reperfusion injury during the perfusion or the process of transplantation, by different mechanisms, transcriptional reprogramming, cell death program and apoptosis, vascular leakage, no reflow phenomenon, autoimmunity, autoantibody and complement activation, innate and adaptive immunity. وبالتالي, they are thinking now of going for normothermic reperfusion versus hypothermic oxygenated perfusion, or to try to put some antioxidants and some vasodilators or some new agents during in the perfusate. This is a publication from Temple University Hospital by Kaplinov et al. About the association between donor hypothermia and allograft outcomes in liver and kidney transplant recipients. I will concentrate, of course, on the kidney. They studied 21,000+ kidney donors. Around half of them received the hypothermia protocol and the other half did not. And they found that while hypothermia remains a life-saving procedure, its benefit on the liver allograft is limited. Regarding the kidney, hypothermic kidney donors have shorter survival but slightly lower rates of chronic and acute rejection. الحقيقة كانت conclusion لطيفة إنه الهايبوثيرميا اللي احنا بنستخدمها أثناء البرفيوجن هتقلل السرفايف but slightly lower rates of chronic and acute rejection. يعني هتقلل الريت برضو of rejection. What about the crosstalk between HLA1 and Toll-like receptor 4 mediates P-selectin expression and monocyte capture to endothelial cell? برضو this is from the University of California, Los Angeles. بتبين انه ال P-selectin, الhypothesis بتاعت ال study دي, انه transplant recipient developing donor-specific HLA antibody are at risk for acute and chronic antibody-mediated rejection. DSA contribute to the process by binding to HLA molecule expressed on endothelial cells. فلو عرفنا ان البايندنج على الاندوثيليال سيل بيبتدي بايه, we can give some drug that abolish this binding. we therefore postulated that HLA class 1 forms a complex with toll-like receptor 4 to induce P-selectin expression and monocyte recruitment. These are the methods used in the study. جابوا primary aortic endothelial cells وابتدوا يعملوا عليها study زي ما حضراتكم شايفين. لقوا الconclusion HLA1 with antibody mediates a signal complex formation between HLA1 and the toll-like receptor to upregulate P-selectin and mediate monocyte recruitment. وطبعا دي ليها future impact in the transplantation في الميكانيزم بتاع transplantation. CD11B is a novel alternate receptor for CD154 during alloimmunity. هنا احنا عارفين ان CD154 bind to CD40 negative cells that are CD11B but not CD11B negative. ولقوا ان في لو حطينا anti CD40 مع ال anti CD11B هيبقى في survival benefit observed أكثر من لو ما حطينا. Lastly, I will be speaking about the COVID in two slides. I almost finished. No transplantation nowadays. No transplantation in spite of having in the COVID armamentum all our transplantation drugs that I mentioned to you before. Interleukin 6, tocilizumab with sarilumab. JAK3 inhibitor, JAK3 اللي هم ممكن يستخدموا في الاميون موديليشن ثيرابي بتاع الكوفيد. انترلوكين 1 الستام سيلز كل دي ترايل في الكوفيد تريتمنت. But we are not using why? Because the susceptibility to infection according to 3 study. This is the Italian National Transplant Center بتبين انه general population where a transplant recipient will wait list patient. A transplant recipient 0.3 while the general population 0.1, we tell you they are 3 times more exposed or susceptible to infection than the general population. Will Swiss transplant cohort, the Italian study on 38,000 transplant patients, the Swiss transplant cohort study done on 5,000 transplant patients, بتقول إنه the general population 0.2, with transplant recipient 0.4, يعني يمكن أقل شوية الـ risk, لكن it is still higher. الأمريكان experience هنا of Yale School of Medicine, New Haven, area has been hardly hit. It is 70 miles from New York, وكان فيها more than 35,000 cases with more than 3,000 deaths. Yale New Haven Hospital peaked at more than 400 COVID-19 inpatients. Living donor transplant has been suspended with deceased donor transplant severely curtailed. Protocol biopsy became difficult. عشان كده هم, they used all the true graph and the donor cell-derived tests that I told you about. Transplant clinic visit converted to telemedicine. Examination of the non-invasive method of detecting subclinical rejection. But the good aspect of the COVID pandemic is what we are doing today. It's extraordinary accomplishment of getting much knowledge in a short time by Zoom or by WebEx. New methods of communication between doctors. No need to travel to get the knowledge. Unprecedented collaboration between scientists and the innovation to combat this disease and to try to get a vaccine as soon as possible, and a more population and public health approach. In summary, American Transplant Congress 2020 was very rich. I tried to, in these 2 hours plus, to give you an idea, but still more, but in my introduction, how to overcome organ shortage, diagnosing rejection, immunosuppression, and desensitization, and basic advances in medicine. Thank you very much. In this difficult time, the hope still lives, and the dream will never die. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Hany Hafez, for this excellent review. It is quite exhaustive for you. So thank you very much. And it is very difficult for anyone to follow all these presentations and to capture the most digestible information. I'd like to start the discussion, 5 minute discussion. We'll start with Professor Tahir Bass. Just a second. Fadla Turtar. Fadla. Turtar.
Aywa.
Fadla Bash Samina.
Masal Khir Gamian.
San Nura Bash.
San Nura.
Doctor Hani Ra'a as usual. Haya. Very, very, very nice.
Allah Khalid.
Details. الواحد يسأل في إيه ولا في إيه ولا في إيه. It's so interesting. عجبني قوي كلامك على الايجينج وعلى الميكروبيوم وكل واحد من دول حقيقه عاوزه separate talk وعن البايوماركرز الجديده وخليني ابدا بالكلمه دي اليوريني بايوماركرز واكتشاف السبكلينيكال ريجكشنز. I believe that subclinical rejection is something يعني عاوزه تبقى focused upon من الترانسبلانتيشن سبيشاليتي عندنا هنا في مصر اكتر. وانا هستشهد مش بالابحاث الخارجيه ولكن بالابحاث الداخليه. كنت ناقشت رسالتين دكتوراه متصلين ببعض مع الدكتوره فاتينة فاضل الحقيقه وكانت نتائج رائعه اقنعتني تماما بلس الليترشر على اهميه السيرفيانس بايوبسي بعيد عن الكوفيد اللي احنا عايشين دلوقتي وباذن الله هينتهي someday and it will be history that's for sure. لكن
yes.
مع وجود البايو ماركرز الكتيره اللي يمكن قلت حضرتك منها في حاجات will be available soon urinary biomarkers as far as I remember. بعيد عن الكلام ده هرجع اقول ان الجول ستاندرد هو surveillance biopsy at the end. yes. لما ننتهي من الايرا اللي مش كويسه. Another comment I would like to make and maybe اسمع comments معانا اخونا الدكتور فيصل شاهين والدكتوره مي عقبت برضو. احنا بنخبط راسنا في الحيط بقالنا 30 سنه تقريبا في الكادافيريك ترانسبلانتيشن. We have to believe that cadaveric transplantation مش ماشي في مصر ولا انت تختلف معايا؟ انا مش مصدق انه
ماشي. طبعا ما انا معاك. ما هو المشكله ان هو You know, it has not got only a scientific aspect. It has got an important political aspect that is beyond our ability.
سمعتها من وزراء بودني مش عاوزين نفتح الباب ده علينا بصراحة. لغاية ما تبقى انت الوزير إن شاء الله. لغاية لما انت تبقى الوزير أو مي أو أي حد مننا ما فيش cadaveric transplantation. يبقى we have to find another way. الواحد لما يلاقي باب مقفول يحاول يدور على سكة تانية. التجربة الناجحة الرائدة عند فيصل شاهين تم ما نسألها ازاي؟
يعني اختار بين اثنين واحدة difficult تبقى desensitized يخليه easily desensitized ففي استخدام له بشكل كبير جدا واعتقد في الجلف مش في السعودية بس بقى في active بير دونيشن بس هو محتاج سياسة واعتقد ان بعد الكوفيد ممكن يتحرك في مصر وتبقى المقاومة بتاعته حتى من الجنرال بوبوليشن قليلة لأنه بيحتاج في اللوجيستكس ان كل من التو كابلز يزرعوا سيمالتينس ان ذا سيم مومنت. الدكتور فيصل نسمع منه بيعملوا ايه في السعوديه.
هو الحقيقه البير دونيشن ات از ا فيري جود بروجرام تو اوفر كم سم اوف ذا بروبلم ويتش از ويز هاي بي ار اي اند انكومباتبل بلاد جروب. ذس وي هاف 3 سنترز ناو امبلمنت ذس دونيشن And they are very successful without any problem. For sure, you have to be secure though that you are doing it in the same time. You have to be secure that no one will ask about if it's failed. So he will ask you about anything. This is something and the patient understand and the family also. But I will return back to the deceased donation, which I think the time will come to Egypt to understand this. It needs some people who is only want to work in this subject, media, people, the religious people. I think there is rigidity from the religious people. If they start with the religious people and then some people to enhance the disease donation in Egypt, it will go. It will take time for sure to change the culture. It's not easy, but we need it because you need liver, you need heart, you need lung. It's not only the kidney. So in the future, yes, you need these organs to be transplanted also. And so many patients in need. And I will tell you, when the political people, some of them suffer or their relatives suffer from this need or they want this need, I am sure that they will help you doing this. Before, maybe China was an outdoor, something which can, you know, someone want to go to have heart, to have lung, he can go abroad. Nowadays, it is difficult. So we have to think to do it in our own place, in our own country. And I'm sure the time will come. If we just said that it is resistant and we cannot know, I think it will go. It will come.
Thank you.
If you allow me, Dr. Hussain. I like a comment of Dr. Faisal very much, and it's not the religious people, it is the politicians. This is for sure. The religious people have agreed upon this issue since a very, very long time. Until this time comes, when a relative of a VIP is in need and things could move, until whatever happens and this is moved. And I was Dr. Hany, Rais al-Jamia al-Masriya. مش هتتعب نفسك اكتر من انا عاوز تاسك فورس من ناس ويلينج وفيهم حضرتك وناس انفلوينشال لان في حد ذاته البردونيشن اللي تفضل الدكتور فيصل وقال لنا ان هو ناجح في مركزين لو بروسيجرز معقده ما هياش بالبساطه اللي ممكن نتخيلها yet it would be much more easier this is something would be a great achievement for our society, I mean the nephrology society, and for the board, if this thing can start to move now, will board اللي بعد كده يكملها, then I think it would take time. بس هو ده يبقى الاتشيفمنت بتاع الجمعية في عهدك يا دكتور هاني, to try to push this,
not
to try, to make it happen.
احنا فعلا يعني يمكن انا ودكتوره مي كنا رحنا قابلنا الوزيره الحاليه من حوالي شهرين قبل الموضوع بتاع الكورونا وكده وكان معانا يعني زي درافت لعدد الحالات اللي هي بيجي لها اند اورجان فيلير وبتموت في مصر خلال 2000 السنه اللي فاتت يعني 2019 وكانوا حوالي ربع مليون حاله يعني اند اورجان فيلير ماتوا ليفر فيلير وريسبيراتوري فيلير وكارديك فيلير وكده من احصائيات وزاره الصحه وكان المين ديفنس بتاعنا انه those patients who died could have been saved لو الناس اللي بتداي in vain some of them بلاش كلهم حتى will give organs او will try to give organs وهي وعدت ان هي يعني بس طبعا اتشغلت بعد كده في 100 قصه بقى لما دخلنا في قصه الكوفيد ودخلنا في اعتقد انه البلاتفورم باي ستريسنج على الاند اورجان مورتاليتي ان ايجيبت وفي نفس الوقت اننا نشوف البلاد اللي حوالينا والانجازات الكبيره اللي عملها الدكتور فيصل في لجنه الترانسبلانتيشن الكادافيريك في الخليج كاكزامبل وحتت كثيره حوالينا في الميدل ايست عامله اعداد كبيره جدا من الحالات زي ايران وكده يعني لو جبنا الامثله دي كلها وعرضناها اعتقد ان ممكن يبقى في تحريك في هذه المايه الراكده
دكتور محمد سعيد
يا دكتور
دكتور محمد السعيد لو اتفضل
اولا شكرا دكتور هاني على المحاضره الجميله يعني فيري هيفي ميل ان ترانسبلانتيشن شابتر يعني ما شاء الله يعني كلها حاجات ابديتد لا بس جميله ما شاء الله عليك ده هو يعني مجهود كبير
يلا دكتور محمد
بقول لك بس هو النقطه
الامريكان اللي تعبونا
بالنسبه للدونر شورتج وفايندنج يعني نيو واي تو انكريز البوتنشال دونر كان في برضه حد بيتكلم كايه بقى ابستراكت في الجونجل ده على ان اكسبت الدونر من اتش سي في بوزيتيف ل اتش سي في نيجاتيف ريسيبيانت وجيفينج ذيم انتي فايرال تريتمنت فور 1 ويك اور 10 دايز وكانت الريسبونس ما شاء الله فيري جود يعني حتى الفيريميا yes. تقريبا كانت باي 1 ويك فانيشد بكوست قليله, وكان النمبر اوف بيشنتس اللي اتعمل لهم من دي بوزيتيف لار نيجاتيف واخذوا بروفلكتيك انتي فايرال تريتمنت 1 داي بري ترانسبلانت و 1 ويك بوست ترانسبلانت, كان الانسيدنس اوف كومبليكيشن كومبارابل مع النيجاتيف نيجاتيف, وكان الجرافت فانكشن طبعا على الشورت تيرم كانت فيري جود. فايه رايك في نقطه HCVD positive؟
طبعا انا موافق تماما دلوقتي مع حضرتك مع التطور الكبير في الادويه بتاعه يعني الادفانسز ان ذا تريتمنت اوف هيباتايتس سي, بقى الكونسرن بتاع البري اور بوست تريتمنت يعني بري اور بوست ترانسبلانتيشن از اوبفيوس ان في ماني ستاديز وي كود تريت بوست ترانسبلانت, وبالتالي if we get a positive donor to a negative patient ما فيش اي مشكله خالص. اعتقد ان الادويه سيف ممكن تستخدم بدرجه كبيره, غير الايرا بتاعت زمان لما كنا بنخاف ندي مثلا الانترفيرون عشان بيعمل ريجكشن او شغله.
بتعرف الليفنج كدني ترانسبلانتيشن دكتور هاني, اتس فيري ديفيكلت تو اكسبت دونر بوزيتيف للريسيبيانت نيجاتيف, لانه الدونر كمان هيبقى ان هارم حتى لو في سيف دراجز افيلبل والانشورنس وهيغطي الكوكتيل اوف ميديكيشنز مش بس وان دراج. القصه فيري ديفيكلت تو بي اكسبتد هير في مصر, يعني ان انا نوافق على دونر بوزيتيف للريسيبيانت نيجاتيف فروم ذا سيك اوف ذا دونر هيم سيلف اور هير سيلف.
هو كل معظم الستاديز دي اتعملت اعتقد على ديزيز
كدافيريك كلها
كدافيريك ماشي, لكن ليفنج دونر لا. انا ما حتى
لكن الكونسبت بتاع انك انت ممكن تاخد اورجن يعني
كدافيريك
كود بي دان في كدافيريك. تمام. اعتقد ان احنا يعني ساعتين وربع يعني اجهدنا حضرتك جامد جدا جدا, لكن
احنا
لسه عندنا كومنت واحد, ودكتور دنيا هي لو عاوز يختم بكومنت. فانا الدكتور خالد ابو زيد كان كاتب سؤال واستسمح حضرتك انا ارد عليه. البارياتريك سيرجي بوست ترانسبلانتيشن ريسيبيانت از ات فيزيبل اور نوت؟ اعتقد انه فيزيبل لو انا عندي موربيد اوبيز ريسيبيانت وعنده انديكيشن للبارياتريك ما نخافش, لان في ستاديز اتنشرت السنه اللي فاتت على البيهيفير بتاع الايمون سابريسيف دراجز, ودرسوا الفارماكاينيتيك والفارماكودينامكس اوف كالسيوم انهيبيتورز, تاكلهم ما فيش مشكله. ويمكن لو بقى في الانفيرسس اللي هو الامبروفد كاينيتيك ده هتبقى القصه سهله, لانه ممتص في نهايه الانتستين والميتابوليزم بتاعه يعني مختلف كتير. حتى التاكرولوماس العادي ما فرقش قوي. الام ام اف لما درسوا الفارماكاينيتيك والفارماكوديناميك ما تاثرش بالبارياتريك سيرجري. فالبارياتريك سيرجري اذا كانت انديكيتد بوست ترانسبلانتيشن تتعمل, وخاصه اللي هو لابروسكوبيك سليف جاستريكتومي. طبعا لو فتحت الدسكشن مش هتخلص القصه, لكن احب دكتور احمد دنيا لانه طلب انه يتكلم فيبقى هو مسك الختام. دكتور احمد
السلام عليكم. دكتور هاني ازاي حضرتك؟
السلام عليكم دكتور احمد ازاي صحتك؟
انا بس يعني حابب اقول لحضرتك طبعا اشكر حضرتك على المحاضره الرائعه دي كالعاده, ويعني احنا بقينا عارفين خلاص ان الدكتور هاني يعني سكاي هاي في العلم, وعنده كمان سكاي هاي في الادب والشعر, بس احنا عايزين حاجه ثالثه بقى, عايزين محاضره يا دكتور هاني بعد اذن حضرتك. ازاي حضرتك بتوفق بين الاثنين بحيث تجيب الابديت بتاع الاي تي سي وتجيب كمان صفحات في كتاب العمر؟
هو ده المعادله الصعبه جدا دكتور احمد. فعلا انت لمست حاجه مهمه, وهو الانسان يعني لا يتجزأ, الانسان لابد روح وماده, ويعني اعتقد دكتور هاني من الناس الفيري كليفر في القصه دي.
هو كل الحقيقه هو كل واحد لو يتابع الهوايه اللي هو بيحبها ويحاول ان هو يبحث في دفاتره القديمه عن هو كان بيحب ايه قبل ما يخش كليه الطب او اثناء ما هو دخل كليه الطب, ويحاول بقى عنده دلوقتي وقت بعد ما طلع على المعاش يحاول على الاقل ينميها, يعني مش شرط بقى يعملها بعد
لا هو
بعد ما طلع على المعاش ممكن يعملها لا هو اثناء الكارير بتاعه يعني.
لا حضرتك بتتميز
اعتقد ان هو ده
لا حضرتك بتتميز بحاجه يعني حاجه يعني تحترم جدا جدا, هو التايم مانجمنت. ما اعرفش حضرتك بتعمل 500 حاجه في 5 دقائق, حاجات كتيره جدا في وقته, والحمد لله يعني النجاح.
انت هتقول في كلام كتير يا حسين هتغر كده يا حسين,
مش هينفع كده. احنا ما يعني ما مش هنوفي حقك في الاجهاد اللي
الله يخليك حبيبي.
واعتقد الفيديو ما ينزل.
انا شاكر لكل الزملاء اللي حضروا وفضلوا قاعدين صابرين ساعتين ونص معايا, وان شاء الله اكون كلهم يعني عن حسن ظنهم يعني.
كلهم حضرتك قامات كبيره جدا, اساتذه افاضل موجودين, الدكتوره دوله بلال, وفي ناس كتيره موجوده أنا قلت بعض الأسماء وفي أسماء كتيرة موجودة معنا من معظم الدول العربية، وطبعاً الدكتور فيصل من الأول معنا، فبحيث
نورنا دكتور فيصل
دايماً يعني بقاله الوقت معنا بيزيد الديسكشن فعلاً وبيخليها ثرية جداً. بشكرك دكتور فيصل، بشكر كل الحضور، وإن شاء الله بكرة بإذن الله هتلاقوا الفيديو أبلودد بإذن الله على الصبح يعني على الساعة 10-11 هتلاقوا موجود على اليوتيوب فري لكل الناس، بحيث اللي فاتوا حاجة ممكن يراجع لها تاني. وأعتقد جماعة اللي بتوع دكتورة الكلى اللي موجودين دلوقتي هم اللي يتعذبوا في الكلام ده يعني باسم الناس كلها، باسم الحضور والناس اللي يسمعوا الفيديو، بتوجه بخلص الشكر والتقدير والتحية لأستاذنا الدكتور هاني حافظ رئيس الجمعية، وطبعا وبنتعلم من حضرتك كتير والكتير. وبتفق مع كلام الدكتور أحمد دنيا إنه إزاي حضرتك بتجمع بين الحاجات دي كلها، وبرضه في يعني في حاجات كتيرة، يعني في مواهب كتيرة جدا تعرفنا عليها بالقرب من حضرتك، وبنشكرك ونتمنى لحضرتك الصحة والعافية، وبنشكر كل الحضور ونلقاكم دايما على خير، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام، متشكرين جدا.
شكرا، عفوا يا باشا،
متشكرين. مع السلامة.